The world. Thank you so much for joining us on the 3-hour news show on Sea Today. Now, for the next 3 hours, we'll bring you the latest from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and also around the world. And among those, we will have some reports from the homecoming trip as well as the Idul Fitri celebration in Kuala Lumpur. We're going to have some live interview and live report from our contributor in Malaysia, Basir Siswo, and also a lot more later in the show. My name is Hans Lango, and in the studio, I'm joined by Hilian Hidrando and Karina Basrewa.
Yeah. Good afternoon.
Not morning.
I'm afraid that you would actually mistaken like the morning.
Yes, I have done that a few times.
You lost the sense of time.
I'm getting there. I'm getting used to it.
It's all good. You guys are only human, you know. How are you guys doing the past few days? You guys have been, you know, holding down the fort.
Oh well, yeah, we have to juggle. For morning and afternoon. Karina had to juggle one day, I had to juggle one day as well. And how are you with your Lebaran day?
Yes.
Lebaran was amazing. It's a big celebration, of course, but you know what happens, big celebration? Somebody just got sick, you know? Always like that, but it's okay, it's all good. Hi everyone, my name is Hilian Hidranto. Welcome to the 3-hour news show. Later on in the show, I'll bring you the latest from the world of sports. Let's see, today we have the Indonesian squad that have arrived in Qatar ahead of the AFC Under-23 Asian Cup 2024. Make sure you stay tuned for all the details. But for now, please do follow us on X, Instagram, and YouTube at See Today News for the latest updates. And let's say hi to Karina for the latest from the business world.
Yes, thank you, Yani. And thank you so much to you folks at home for joining us this Friday night. To those who celebrate, we hope you have had a blessed Eid. I am Karina Basrewan, and with what Yani has just said, we'll indeed cover the business updates. We'll take a look at the market from the country, the region, and elsewhere around the world. But first, let us take a look at what made the top stories for today. Take it away, Hans.
Thank you so much, Karina. The first one, several tourist destinations, including National Monument in central Jakarta, just across our office, are still crowded with visitors days after Eid celebration.
Religious and Islamic-themed movies are currently trending in Indonesia, drawing in over 1 million viewers and ranking up millions of dollars in revenue.
In sports, Indonesian shuttlers Rino Frivaldi and Pita Haningtyas Mentari are set to compete at the 2024 Paris Olympics after moving to the round of 16 of the Badminton Asia Championships.
And later in our See the Story segment, we will learn how sound effects are made in movies with American Foley artist Sana Kelly. Stay tuned over here. All right, ladies, let's jump into our first story for today. And this is the first story comes from Gaza, where more Palestinians returned to their heavily damaged homes in the central city of Khan Yunis in the Gaza Strip on Thursday.
Their return became possible after Israeli troops withdrew from the city, which is the second largest in the territory, on Sunday.
The residents found their home city unrecognizable, with thousands of buildings destroyed or damaged. Some buildings still stood, but were gutted shells, scorched and full of holes, with partially shattered upper floors.
Among those who returned was Ishraf Kudeh, who spent the day clearing the rubble in what was left of her apartment. Despite the devastating destruction, she said it was better to be home than staying in a tent in a camp for the displaced.
Israel sent troops into Khan Yunis in December, part of its blistering ground offensive against Palestinian resistance. It claims the city was a major Hamas stronghold and that its operation there killed thousands of Palestinian civilians, including women and children.
الخيم والاجواء اللي احنا فيها لسه يمكن عرادهم بيوتنا اول ما نقعد في مكان ثاني
بعد حوالي 70 يوم نزوح في دير البلح قررت ان ارجع بعد ما هم انسحبوا اليوم طبعا قررت ان ارجع والاقي هذا الدمار الهائل اللي موجود في البيت يعني البيت اصبح غير صالح اطلاقا للسكن فأنا قررت أن ما أرجعش على البلح كود اليهود هذول مش موجودين هنا.
Dozens of aid trucks entered Gaza through Rafah crossing on Thursday morning, and international pressure for Israel to allow humanitarian supplies into the besieged enclave.
The trucks were seen passing the crossing and heading to the United Nations depot in Rafah, Gaza's most southern city, where they were offloaded.
Amongst the supplies were tinned vegetables and baby products. Israel promised the U.S. it would dramatically ramp up aid to Gaza in exchange for continued American support for the war, saying last week it would open another crossing and surge more drugs into the besieged enclave than ever before.
Over the last few days, UN workers said there's been only a slight increase in the aid making it into Gaza. Before the war, 500 trucks carrying food, fuel, and other supplies entered Gaza daily. After initially sealing Gaza's border in the early days of the war, Israel began permitting entry of humanitarian supplies, but the number of trucks arriving remains below the pre-war average.
Still around the Eid celebration, Muslims in South Africa perform prayers at the start of the Eid al-Fitr holiday, marking the end of the holy month of Ramadan that in the country started on Thursday.
Men and women listened to imams preaching at sermons in Cape Town, where prayer started just before sunrise, lasting for about an hour.
This year, Eid is coming just after the Israel-Hamas war crosses the somber milestone of having stretched on for half a year. With no confirmed sighting of the moon in South Africa, the Council of Muslim Theologians in the country determined that Ramadan will end on April 10th, meaning that Eid al-Fitr started on Thursday.
Since the war broke out in the Gaza Strip in October, the Muslims in Cape Town has come out in support of Palestinians. Members of the community have led large-scale protests in solidarity and staged various other events to pledge support.
Ramadan, it's a time of communal harmony, it's a time of unity, it's a time of love. It's a time where we've emerged out of a period of self-discipline, self-introspection, a time of spiritual, moral, physical training, training ourselves to be disciplined, training ourselves to abstain from food. But that abstinence of food and worldly pleasures goes beyond just, it allows us to carry that forward in everything that we do in our lives.
During this day of Eid, however we are celebrating, but we're remembering our brothers and sisters in Palestine, in Gaza, those who are suffering and facing a genocide taking place as we are talking now.
And let's go back to Indonesia for a while, where Transportation Minister Budi Karya Sumadi made an inspection earlier this morning to Soekarno-Hatta International Airport ahead of the return flow of Eid homecoming season.
He predicted the peak of the return flow is likely to occur on Monday, with travelers exceeding 1,236.
The inspection was held along the Terminal 1, where Minister Budi looked over the passenger traffic that will continue to surge upon the peak of the homecoming return flow.
The minister also expressed high appreciation to airport officials for their hard work and dedication to safeguard and take care of the passengers during the busiest period of the year. He says the number of passengers will hit its peak on Monday to reach around 190,000.
Sekarang sudah mencapai 1.236, mendekati tahun 2019 1.280. Surprise-nya adalah jumlah penumpangnya lebih besar. Kalau di Jakarta lebih besar 101% dibandingkan 2019 dan 104% di Bali. Nah, caranya tadi saya bicara dengan Kapolres, ini tidak mungkin terjadi kalau kita tidak melakukan kolaborasi. Semua sektor, API, Airnav, lalu kepolisian, biaya cukai, lalu imigrasi, terus juga Osman, Airline, komplit anak-anak. Ya, harus sama-sama, saling mengisi. Ya. Saya hanya mengingatkan ya, bahwa biasanya di titik balik ini problemnya dia di bagasi.
A boat accident took place on Tuesday off Tanjung Keramat Waters in Riau's Indragiri Hilir Regency.
And the incident has left a crew member deceased.
The Diva NH1 speedboat carrying 60 passengers was en route from Katiman District to Tembilahan City when it collided with another speedboat driven by Captain Yanto.
Yanto was navigating through high waves carrying empty oil barrels when the two ships approached each other from opposite directions.
The captain suffered injuries in the face and body while his crew member fell overboard. All passengers, however, remained safe, except for one. The joint forces of military, police, rescue teams, and locals have managed to recover the dead body earlier today.
Dari speedboat beliau di posisi kanan jalur melihat speedboat 40 PK melakukan manuver menghindari ombak yang dilalui oleh speedboat sebelumnya yaitu speedboat Ocean. Ketika manuver tersebut speedboat yang awalnya berada di posisi kiri melakukan manuver ke sebelah kiri ataupun ke sebelah kanan dari speedboat 200 PK Diva NH01 mengakibatkan lambung dari speedboat Anugrah menabrak lambung kiri dari speedboat Diva 01 dan menyebabkan speedboat Anugrah Ibu mengalami kerusakan dan korban atas nama Yanto yang merupakan nakoda dari speedboat Anugrah mengalami luka-luka. Kemudian terdapat keterangan bahwasanya ada rekannya yang satu lagi yang ikut di dalam boat Anugrah Ibu yang bernama Meran yang terjatuh di perairan Tanjung Keramat.
From the capital city, several tourist destinations, including the Ragunan Zoo in South Jakarta, are still crowded with tourists days after Eid celebrations.
Yes, and a crowd of tourists was also seen at the National Monument in Gambir, Central Jakarta, earlier today.
The National Monument, or Monas, in Gambir, Central Jakarta, has become one of the popular tourist destinations among residents in Jakarta and other cities across Indonesia during holiday seasons. It is claimed as one of the best places to introduce the history of Indonesia to visitors. During Eid holidays, it is predicted that the number of visitors at the monument will continue to increase until Sunday.
Karena sekalian nganter anak tadi pulang ke Semarang, jadi mampir juga belum pernah ke Monas selama di Jakarta. Pengen naik ke atasnya. Nyaman ya, ternyata apa karena masih pagi jadi nggak rame banget.
From South Jakarta, a long queue of vehicles was seen along the entrance of Ragunan Zoo. Many tourists chose to visit the zoo mainly due to its affordable tickets prices and educational tourism, where visitors, especially children, can learn more about animals.
Tiket, alhamdulillah di sini kan murah ya. Kita rombongan aja paling cuma nggak nyampe 100.000 paling. Rombongan sama keluarga. Udah gitu, jalurnya juga kalau lagi lebaran gini kan nggak macet gitu. Lenggang, enak.
Dari Bogor, Mas.
Kesini sama siapa?
Sama keluarga.
Bawa keluarga.
Bawa anak-anak juga sih ke sini sama rame-rame daripada ke Bogor lagi ke kolam renang kan belum pernah ke sini gitu, pengen lihat.
Ragunan Zoo authorities have prepared more facilities including additional parking lots to accommodate a surge in visitors. The zoo is now open from 7 a.m. during Eid holidays from April the 11th to 21st. Meanwhile, ticket costs 4,000 rupiah for adults and 3,000 rupiah for children. C2D contributors reporting from Jakarta.
Yes, the homecoming trip has been an annual tradition among Indonesians during Eid holidays, but some, like us, chose to stay at home to travel around Jakarta.
That's right. To accommodate tourists in Jakarta, TransJakarta is extending the operational hour of its double-decker tourist bus from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m.
Eid homecoming has become a tradition among Indonesians, especially those residing in Jakarta. However, some chose to spend their holidays here in the capital. To accommodate local residents and tourists, Jakarta's double-decker tourist bus, known as Jakarta Explorer, is extending its operational hour during the holidays. The bus is now operating from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., starting from April the 11th to the 15th, from its original operating hour from 10 p.m. to 5 p.m. There are two types of double-decker buses, namely the regular bus with a full roof and another one with an open roof on the second deck, allowing tourists to enjoy the weather of Jakarta.
Such a beautiful day, isn't it? So I'm currently at this double-decker bus where I'm currently sightseeing across the city of Jakarta. And there's the icon behind me, which is the Cathedral Church. So with this bus, you can go sightseeing across the landmarks and the icons that's very historical in the city of Jakarta. And this bus is currently operating since 9 a.m. up until 5 p.m.
The double-decker buses also serve four routes during the holidays. The BW1 route takes tourists to historic places across Jakarta, including Istiqlal Mosque and Bank Indonesia Museum, while the BW2, which features the theme of New Jakarta, traverses National Museum to Istiqlal Mosque. Meanwhile, the BW4 route explores Jakarta's iconic skyscrapers through Sudirman Road. Last but never the least, the BW9 route travels around Pantai Indah Kapuk areas.
So using this double-decker bus, you can hop on and hop off at any bus stop that you want, and you can pick whichever landmark or icon that you want to visit. And I think I would like to visit the National Monument, and it is right here. So I'm going to stop here at the National Monument. And what's more important is that using this bus, you can travel for free as long as you bring your electronic card money. Maudie Kalisha and Dipta Diwiguna for See Today.
All right, thank you so much, Maudie Kalisha. And apparently, she got the brown memo.
That's weird.
All right, we're going for the first quick break for this hour, but when I come back, we'll have the latest from Southeast Asia and also around the world.
And later on during the hour, I'll bring you the latest from the world of business.
So stay with us right here on the 3-Hour News Show on See Today.
Selamat malam pemirsa See Today. Kita ketemu lagi di Ngonten, ngobrolin tentang Nusantara.
Jadi gandrong gandring, Chris kumpul gandring.
Iya, itu dia. Chris
kumpul gandring. Amin ya. Apa ini?
Dari mana? Dari mana? Kira menurut kamu ini dari mana? Dari daerah mana? Dari negara lain ini?
Malaysia. Dari China? Bukan. India.
Asia Tenggara aja boleh gak? Namanya See Today. See Today Southeast Asian.
Ke Binjai mau migrasi.
Cakep.
Anjay, aku deport sih.
Aku cuma mau bilang hari ini kamu tuh cantik ya.
Aduh ya Allah. Baru kali ini.
Oke lah kalau penampilan dia nggak sebaik itu, nggak sebagus itu, nggak seganteng itu. Tapi tuh hatinya dia sebaik itu dan tidak ada orang yang pernah gue temuin hatinya sebaik Mas.
Pemain.
K
Good morning, Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and the world. Rise and shine, everyone. Back to our regular scheduled programming here on the C Morning Show. It is just past 6 in the a.m. And for the next 3 hours, myself along with my colleagues will be sharing with you all the latest news and updates from Indonesia and beyond. And time for your first sports update of the morning. We're going to begin with some updates from the world of football. We've got a talk show coming up as well and your latest viral news as well.
Welcome to City Day Business, your go-to source for the latest economic and business updates from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the globe.
Get ready for a power-packed show of insights, interviews, and analysis that will keep you ahead of the curve.
Join us Monday to Friday right at your lunch hour as we dive deep into the world of business, only on
City Day Business.
Hello, you're watching C2Day Updates at 2 p.m. with me, Aris Satya. Let's begin the first story where the Indonesian government humanitarian aid for Palestine arrived at the Cairo International Airport on Thursday after a 12-hour flight with Garuda Indonesia. The humanitarian aid delivery was instructed by Indonesian President Joko Widodo, who explained that it showed the commitment of the Indonesian government to maintain world peace and be involved in humanitarian mission due to war or disaster.
Kayaknya lucu juga nih kalau dapur kita kasih warna, nggak cuma warna coklat, warna putih, yang ternyata emang berhasil naikin mood rumah ini sih.
Untuk jendela, pintu, dan furniturnya semuanya harus simple dan minimalis.
Kalau misalnya bolongannya dari utara, itu pasti lebih banyak angin yang masuk.
Absolutely delicious.
You know, it's actually pretty good.
Satu, dua, tiga.
Indonesia! Come see the nature, only on See Indonesia.
Come see the beauty, only on See Indonesia.
Only on See Indonesia.
Ready to score a touchdown?
Oh, I was born ready.
Let's go.
Let's go.
Go.
Figur publik kok kere.
Perlombaan ini tuh seperti mendaki Everest 3 kali.
Gitu. Apa sih yang dicari? Bini setuju aja?
Harus setuju, saya jadi batu.
Siapa sih yang ngajarin kamu sekuat ini?
Ada Pak Habibie katanya gitu, bikin.
Bikin pesawat?
Bikin pesawat gitu.
Simsalabim!
Simsalabim!
Abrakadabra!
Abrakadabra!
Singgobang gosir!
Singgobang gosir!
Pala botak gak bisa disisir!
Pala botak gak bisa.
Hello and welcome back to the show now. We have some more updates for you from all around Indonesia and also Southeast Asia. The first one coming from the majority of it. Homecoming travelers are expected to arrive in Jakarta by train during the return flow.
We have the exclusive report from our news team Reski Anasto and Arya Sidarta at Pasar Senen Station in central Jakarta.
As we are right now on the returning flow of the Idul Fitri 2024 holiday homecoming trip, and we are seeing that the Pasar Senen Station, as I'm located right now at Pasar Senen Station, people are seeing coming and going going from Jakarta and also arriving at Jakarta. And this Pasasnan station is rather busy since the morning based on our observation. And according to the data from the Indonesian Railways, from period of March 31st until yesterday, April 11th, the Indonesian Airways have dispatched more than 500,000 passengers by long distance train. And according to the data from today from the Indonesian Railways, that people are more likely coming or arriving to Jakarta, which recorded around 40,000 people are recorded going to Jakarta or arriving at Jakarta. And also that meanwhile, the tickets that have been sold, as for from the data that we have today, it is as many as 705,000 tickets, which is more than 705,000 tickets that already been sold for this from 31st until the whole of the homecoming trip or the home returning of the homecoming trip, with there are still seats available as many as more than 194,000 seats or average of 19,000 seats per day. And the peak of this returning flow of the homecoming trip, it is predicted to be on 13, 14 and 15 of April 2024. And as already we have a statement from public relation of Indonesian Railways Jakarta, Xvan Henry Wintoko, and this is his statement.
Sedangkan untuk pantauan arus balik akan terjadi pada tanggal 13, 14 dan 15 April 2024, karena pada tanggal-tanggal tersebut terdapat sebanyak 44.000 lebih penumpang perharinya yang menuju Daop 1 Jakarta.
And as for the departure data from April 12, which is today, it is there are around 37,525 passengers with 75 train or trips that will leave Jakarta for today, which more than 13,000 from Gambir Station and more than 23,000 from Pasar Senen Station. And distribution of the favorite cities such as Surabaya, Malang, Solo, Yogyakarta, Kuto Arjosemarang, and Purwokerto. And as for the people that who wants to buy the ticket, there are still many tickets are still available for this returning flow of the homecoming trip. And for more information, you can access or purchase from the website of the Indonesian Railways or PT KAI, or the application from PT KAI, and also contact the customer service of PT KAI. Reporting from Pasar Senen Station, Central Jakarta, Reski Anasto and Arya Sidarta for C2Day.
Thank you so much, Reski Anasto and Arya Sidarta from Pasar Senen Station in Jakarta. And the tradition of homecoming is not only felt in Indonesia, but also in Malaysia, our neighboring country. Even the capital city of Kuala Lumpur, which is famous for traffic jams, is much less crowded during the Eid holidays.
And for the latest situation, we are now joined by our C2Day contributor in Malaysia, Basir Siswo. Basir, selamat hari raya. Please do tell us, how is Eid celebration in Malaysia?
Very good evening, Jakarta. Salam Lebaran. I'm here in Bukit Jelutong, Shah Alam, Selangor. It's about 20 kilometers away from the heart of Kuala Lumpur, which is basically has become almost a ghost town with the notorious traffic jam non-existent the last 5 days at least, as people have left the city to go back to their hometown since Saturday to celebrate Hari Raya with the families. An interesting point in this year's celebration is the heat wave that's sweeping across the country the last 1 month or so. People up north, actually, are getting about 40 degrees centigrade temperature, and it's causing a lot of discomfort. I was there the last 3 days, actually, celebrating with my wife's family. And even in the remote villages, people are installing air conditioning in the living room to make it comfortable for visitors to come and visit their parents. So the discomfort is obvious. Well, people in the villages are suffering this Hari Raya, but I think the celebration must go on. It's, the heat is better than rain. Mm-hmm. However, the concern raised by the authorities over the last 2 days is the very high number of traffic accidents on the road. In fact, the last 2 days alone, there are more than 3,000 traffic accidents in Peninsular Malaysia, with about 50 plus people killed on the road. Yesterday, on Wednesday alone, the first day of Hari Raya, 25 people were killed. That's a very high number. And the concern now is that when people would be coming back to KL on Saturday, after the long holidays, there'll be another rush back to the city. And authorities are now reminding people to be extra careful, take extra precautions to avoid any unnecessary incidents to the family.
Mm-hmm. So, Basir, you were saying about the location that you are at the moment, mm-hmm. kind of like mm-hmm. ghost town. So, you must have heard about how Indonesians in this homecoming trip getting to a number mm-hmm. of the highest number in the last couple of years, 190 mm-hmm. more than 190 million people going for a homecoming trip, not only from Jakarta to any other area, but actually it's within the country itself. Do you have any mm-hmm. number of how many people in Malaysia going for a homecoming trip throughout this holiday and also within the country?
Well, according to the statistics, vehicles moving across the Peninsular Malaysia alone the last 2 days, about 2 million.
Wow.
So if you times that by 5, you're looking at about 10 million people moving around Peninsular Malaysia the last 5 days or so.
Mm-hmm. But mainly through the road, I mean, with cars and stuff like that. But how about flights or, any other means of transportation?
Especially people living in Borneo, in Sabah, in Sarawak. Flights are very expensive during this festive season. In fact, I have some friends here. They have not been going back to Sabah, for example, for mm-hmm. the last 4 days because flight tickets have gone up like 3 times. So he will only go back after Hari Raya, where the flight tickets are back to normal.
I see. All right. So we got that actually, and apparently it's in our culture, not only in Indonesia but also in the Malayan Peninsula with our neighboring countries with the same culture background.
Yep.
It's actually in our blood. So Basir Siswa from Malaysia, thank you so much, and once again, Selamat Hari Raya, Aidil Fitri for you and also your family, and send our regards to the people of Malaysia. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Jakarta.
All right, so that was Basir Siswa
yes.
From Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. And we did hear about the numbers and also not only the amount of people going for the homecoming trip,
yep.
but also, unfortunately, a lot of accidents that happened and it drawn quite many casualties in that sense. And we hope that no other accident will happen, whether it's in Indonesia or in other countries which are also having some homecoming trips in the country. And on to another story. Real estate tycoon Chuang Mai Lan was sentenced to death on Thursday by a court in Ho Chi Minh City in southern Vietnam in the country's largest financial fraud case ever.
The 67-year-old chair of the real estate company, Van Thien Phat, was formally charged with fraud amounting to $12.5 billion, or nearly 3% of the country's 2022 GDP.
Lund illegally controlled Saigon Joint Stock Commercial Bank between 2012 and 2022 to allow 2,500 loans that resulted in losses of $27 billion to the bank. The court asked her to compensate the bank $26.9 million.
Former central bank official Do Thi Nan was also sentenced to life in prison for accepting $5.2 million in bribes. Lan's arrest in October 2022 was among the most high profile in an ongoing anti-corruption drive in Vietnam that has intensified since 2022.
The so-called Blazing Furnace campaign has touched the highest echelons of Vietnamese politics. Former President Pho Phan Thuong resigned in March after being implicated in the campaign.
Brazil's Foreign Minister Mauro Vieira met with his Vietnamese counterpart Bui Tan Son in Hanoi on Wednesday during a trip to boost the bilateral relations.
During the meeting, Vieira said Brazil and Vietnam have developed very special bilateral relations since they established diplomatic relations 35 years ago. Brazil is Vietnam's leading partner in Latin America, with two-way trade reaching $7.1 billion last year. Son said the relationship is well-rounded in traditional friendship and shared values of peace, cooperation, and development.
He expressed hopes that the relation will grow broader and deeper, both bilaterally and multilaterally. Vieira was also scheduled to meet with Prime Minister Pham Minh Chinh during the visit.
It is even more necessary. The relationship between our two countries is well grounded in traditional friendship and shared values of peace, cooperation, and development. Brazil is Vietnam's leading partner in Latin America. We hope that our bilateral relations, both bilaterally and multilaterally, shall grow broader and deeper.
We have been able in 35 years to develop a very special bilateral relation. We have a very high important volume of bilateral trade, which we want to work hard to enhance and to make it grow even bigger.
Karen ethnic guerrillas on Thursday claimed to have captured the last army outpost in Miawadi Township of eastern Myanmar. The Karen National Union, the ethnic group's leading political body, said in a Facebook statement that its armed wing and allies had captured the garrison of Infantry Battalion 275 about 4 kilometers to the west of the town before dawn after besieging it since the start of the week.
The fall of Miawadi could spell another major setback in the army's war against resistance forces, which began last October when an ethnic rebel alliance launched an offensive in the northeast. Over the past 5 months, the army has been routed in the Shan state, where it surrendered control of several border crossings with China, and in Rakhine state in the west, and is facing active challenges elsewhere. And the next one coming from Indonesia, Ara D-Day Military Sector Commander, Second Lieutenant Octavianus Sogalre, was fatally shot by an armed criminal group in Papua on Wednesday.
The commander was traveling to Pasir Putih village when the attack took place.
Video footage uploaded by the armed criminal group, which you are seeing at the moment, showed the commander being shot while riding a motorbike. He was then attacked with sharp weapons as he fell to the ground.
Spokesperson for the Cendrawasih Military District Command, Lieutenant Colonel Chandra Kurniawan, has confirmed the victim's identity.
He added that victim's body was discovered a day after the incident, following a joint search by the police and armed forces. The body has been evacuated to Nabire.
Kita sangat menyesalkan kejadian penembakan yang dilakukan oleh OPM terhadap Dan Ramil di Kabupaten Paniai. Kita lihat sendiri di video itu sudah ditembak, namun begitu tergeletak, tidak berdaya, masih dianiaya sampai meninggal. Tentunya ini menjadikan catatan baik kita yang selama ini OPM selalu berteriak menyampaikan pelanggaran HAM, tapi ternyata kita bisa lihat jadinya seperti itu. Meninggalnya ini diawali pada saat hari Rabu sore, almarhum keluar dari Koramil menuju ke kampung Pasir Putih, namun pada saat ditunggu sampai hari Kamis pagi tidak ada.
And that update concluded our segment. Now we're going for another break.
And after the break, Karina will deliver some economics and business updates.
Yes, let's welcome her back in.
Hello.
Karina, what do you have for us?
Yes, we have interest rates in Argentina as well as updates from Tesla. So all the business updates just for you from Indonesia and beyond. So stay here only on the 3-Hour News Show on See Today.
Absolutely delicious.
You know, it's actually pretty good.
Satu, dua, tiga.
Indonesia! Come see the nature, only on See Indonesia.
Come see the beauty, only on See Indonesia.
Only on See Indonesia.
Ready to score a touchdown?
Oh, I was born ready.
Let's go.
Let's go.
Go.
Figur publik kok kere. Perlombaan ini tuh seperti mendaki Everest 3 kali.
Apa sih yang dicari? Bini setuju aja?
Harus setuju, saya jadi batu.
Siapa sih yang ngajarin kamu sekuat ini?
Ada Pak Habibie katanya gitu, bikin.
Bikin pesawat?
Bikin pesawat gitu.
Simsalabim!
Simsalabim!
Abrakadabra!
Abrakadabra!
Singgobangkosir!
Singgobangkosir!
Pala botak gak bisa disisir!
Pala botak gak bisa.
Selamat malam pemirsa See Today. Kita ketemu lagi di Ngonten, ngobrolin tentang Nusantara.
Dari gandrong gandring, Chris empuk gandring.
Iya, itu dia. Chris
empuk gandring. Jadi apa ini?
Dari mana? Dari mana? Kira menurut kamu ini daerah mana? Dari daerah mana? Dari negara lain ini?
Malaysia.
Dari China?
Bukan.
India?
Bukan. Asia Tenggara aja boleh gak? Namanya See Today. See Today Southeast Asian.
Eid al-Fitr is a time to share and cherish with loved ones. I am Jose Tavares from Moscow, wishing you a joyous Eid filled with love, peace, and abundant blessings. Eid Mubarak to all of you.
Kayaknya kalau gue pakai warna itu hari ini akan senang deh.
Ya kan gue menikah, jadi saya masih dapat angpau sih.
Ya, gue yang penting apa yang gue makan bisa gue buang pada saat gue olahraga. Gitu.
And
And welcome back to the 3-hour news show. We're reaching 6 in the p.m. here in the studio in Jakarta, which means it's time for some economic updates. And the first order of business is Argentina's central bank that recently has cut its interest rate and is expected to reduce inflation in the future. The bank announced on Thursday that it has cut its benchmark interest rate by 10% from 80 to 70%. This big move underscored the government confidence over bringing down inflation since August 2023 that reached 276.2% annually in February 2024. The bank is seeing pronounced slowdown in inflation despite the strong statistical drag that the inflation carries in its monthly averages after the initial correction of relative prices in December 2023. The government previously expected that inflation will fall from its peak of 25% in December 2023 to nearly 10% in March 2024, following a sharp currency devaluation by President Javier Milei. This is the third adjustment after President Milei took office in December 2023. His tight fiscal policies have boosted the mood of investors in Argentina, propelling shares and bonds, although poverty levels are increasing along with an economic recession. And our next update comes here from Indonesia, where the film industry has made history in 2023, where 20 local films each broke the 1 million viewers, marking the highest achievement in over a decade.
Each of the 20 Indonesian films managed to attract more than 1 million viewers in 2023. Data from filmindonesia.or.id indicated that this is the highest achievement in the last 11 years, ranging from 2013 to 2023. A horror film titled Suudino was in first place with more than 4,800,000 viewers. It was followed by another horror film titled The Ambang Kematian with more than 3,300,000 viewers. It means that those 20 films reached a total of more than 40,472,000 viewers. If the movie ticket were priced at 35,000 rupiah, the revenue generated in 1 year alone would exceed more than 1.4 trillion rupiah. The achievement of 20 domestic films with each hitting over 1 million viewers in 2023 is a positive sign for the Indonesian film industry. Thus, to support its growth, Cinema XX1 plans to add 100 new screens across Indonesia in 2024. Kalau mau diajarin nyanyi, gimana kalau manggilnya
ibu? Meanwhile, religious and Islamic-themed movies have also been a hit in Indonesia, with at least 8 such films drawing in over a million viewers and racking up millions of dollars in revenue.
Kalau Mbak yang tetap ingin mengambil Baskara dari kami, akan banyak hati yang hancur di rumah ini.
Indonesian religious Islamic-themed films have quietly captivated hearts of million viewers. At least 8 films have more than a million viewers each. Topping the list is a 2008 Ayat Ayat Cinta with over 3.6 million viewers, generating revenue of 107 billion rupiah. Following closely is Air Mata di Ujung Sajadah with over 3.1 million viewers. In the third place, Ayat Ayat Cinta 2 collected more than 2.8 million viewers and exceeded 104 billion rupiah in revenue.
Ada banyak tokoh perempuan hebat dalam perkembangan sejarah Islam.
Despite horror movies dominating the local cinema, these successes shows a strong appeal of Islamic-themed films in Indonesian cinema.
Tidak masalah. Penjelasan Anda bagus.
The aforementioned 8 movies alone boast over 17 million viewers, and Ayat Ayat Cinta currently ranks 13th in the top 100 most viewed Indonesian films of all time.
And those were the economic and business updates that we have for you for this hour. We're due for another short break, but when we return, Yanni will be bringing you the updates from the world of sports. Stay with us on a three-hour news show only on See Today.
Kebinjai, mau migrasi.
Cakep!
Anjay, aku depot sih.
Wee!
Ya, aku cuma mau bilang hari ini kamu tuh cantik loh.
Aduh, ya Allah! Baru kali ini.
Oke lah kalau penampilan dia gak sebaik itu, gak sebagus itu, gak seganteng itu. Tapi tuh hatinya dia sebaik itu dan tidak ada orang yang pernah gue temuin hatinya sebaik Mars.
Pemain!
Good morning, Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and the world. Rise and shine, everyone. Back to our regular scheduled programming here on the Sea Morning Show. It is just past 6 in the a.m. And for the next 3 hours, myself along with my colleagues will be sharing with you all the latest news and updates from Indonesia and beyond. And time for your first sports update of the morning. We're going to begin with some updates from the world of football. We've got a talk show coming up as well and your latest viral news as well.
Welcome to City Day Business, your go-to source for the latest economic and business updates from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the globe.
Get ready for a power-packed show of insights, interviews, and analysis that will keep you ahead of the curve.
Join us Monday to Friday right at your lunch hour as we dive deep into the world of business, only on
City Day Business.
Hello, you're watching See Today Updates at 2 p.m. with me, Aris Satya. Let's begin the first story where the Indonesian government humanitarian aid for Palestine arrived at the Cairo International Airport on Thursday after a 12-hour flight with Garuda Indonesia. The humanitarian aid delivery was instructed by Indonesian President Joko Widodo, who explained that it showed the commitment of the Indonesian government to maintain world peace and be involved in humanitarian mission due to war or disaster.
Absolutely delicious.
You know, it's actually pretty good.
Satu, dua, tiga.
Indonesia!
Come see the nature, only on See Indonesia.
Come see the beauty, only on See Indonesia.
Only on See Indonesia.
Hi viewers, welcome back to the 3-Hour News Show on See Today. It is time for some sports updates with me, Hilyani Hidranto. First up, Indonesian shuttlers Rino Frivaldi and Pita Haningtyas Mentari are set to compete at the 2024 Paris Olympics after advancing to the round of 16 of the 2024 Badminton Asia Championships. Frivaldi and Mentari, however, failed to reach the quarterfinals after losing to South Korea's Soo Seong-jae and Cha Yu-jung 18-21 and 14-21. Now, the pair secured their tickets to the multi-sporting event after their opponents in the top 16 race to Paris match, namely Singapore's Hee Yong-kai Terry and Tan Wei-han Jessica, and fellow Indonesian mixed doubles pair Dejan Ferdiansyah and Gloria Emmanuel Wijaya were eliminated in the round of 16. Two Indonesian men's single players are through to the quarterfinals of Badminton Asia Championship 2024 in Ningbo, China. But on the women's side, Gregoria Mariska Tunjung is the only Indonesian player left.
Two Indonesian men's single players, Anthony Sinisuka Ginting and Jonathan Christie, have advanced to the quarterfinals of the Badminton Asia Championship 2024. At the Ningbo Olympic Sports Center Gymnasium, China, Anthony Ginting defeated Somi Romdani of the United Arab Emirates 21-9, 21-10, and in 31 minutes. Now the other quarterfinal spot went to Jonathan Christie, who saw the challenge from Hong Kong's Lee Chuk Yew in straight games, 21-14 and 21-16. Meanwhile, only one Indonesian women's singles player remained. Gregoria Mariska Tunjung advanced to the quarterfinals after defeating Pai Yu Po of Taiwan. Tunjung, who was down 7-11 in the first game, managed to turn it around and win it 21-19. And she booked her place in the quarters after winning the second game 21-16. Now let's move on to football now. Ahead of the AFC Under 23 Asian Cup 2023, the Indonesian squad arrived in Qatar Wednesday evening. Straight away, Coach Shin Tae-yong held a training session for the team in preparation for their match against host Qatar on April 15th.
The Indonesian squad have arrived in Qatar ahead of the AFC Under 23 Asian Cup 2024. Without wasting a lot of time, straight away, Coach Shin Tae-yong held the first training session at the Abdullah bin Khalifa Training Stadium in Doha. Although it was only for physical recovery, the young Garuda team trained hard to get their synergy right in preparation for their opening match against the host nation, Qatar, on April the 15th.
Latihannya tidak terlalu berat, latihan ringan, tapi tetap fokus dan kerja keras. Dan coaching staff juga memberikan pesan dan motivasi untuk kita bisa sampai final nanti. Untuk persiapan khusus sih pastinya ada ya. Untuk kita juga saling support satu sama lain, dan ya kiper pasti berusaha lebih lagi.
The Indonesian team are in Qatar after a 10-day training camp in the United Arab Emirates, during which the young Garuda played two trial matches. Indonesia lost 3-1 to Saudi Arabia and won 1-0 against UAE.
Up next, we have tennis updates just for you. Host Australia moved to within a victory of reaching the Billie Jean King Cup finals after sweeping both opening matches of their qualifier tie with Mexico in Brisbane on Friday. Arina Rodionova recovered from a set down to defeat Guliana Olmos in the opening clash 3-6, 6-3, 6-1 to give Australia a 1-0 lead. Daria Savie then dispatched Marcela Zacharias in straight set 6-1, 6-love in the second singles on Friday to give Australia a 2-love lead heading into Saturday's final day of the tie. Savie was playing in place of Storm Hunter, who suffered an ankle injury in practice on Thursday and now faces a prolonged spell on the sidelines. The seven-time champion Australia need one win on Saturday to advance to November's finals. Australia are seeking its first Billie Jean King Cup since 1974. And that is all the time we have for sports this hour. But when we return, we'll have more information just for you. So keep it right here on the 3-Hour News Show on See Today.
Kayaknya lucu juga nih kalau dapur kita kasih warna, nggak cuma warna coklat, warna putih, yang ternyata emang berhasil naikin mood rumah ini sih.
Untuk jendela, pintu, dan furniturnya semuanya harus simple dan minimalis.
Kalau misalnya bolongannya dari utara, itu pasti lebih banyak angin yang masuk.
gue yang penting apa yang gue makan bisa gue buang pada saat gue olahraga sih gitu.
Jadi Abila kalau ketemu mungkin dia ketawa gitu.
Dengan proses gue bersyukur banget Kubu Junior tuh sempat bubar tahun 2016-2017.
Pilihnya sabu-sabu karena sabu-sabu kita cuma makannya setahun sekali.
Kalau kita dengerin Spotify ya, Pak gimana sih caranya aku bisa masuk di sini ke gitu. Ya nggak boleh menghalangi lah.
Figur publik kok kere.
Perlombaan ini tuh seperti mendaki Everest 3 kali.
Apa sih yang dicari? Bini setuju aja?
Orang setuju, saya jadi batu.
Siapa sih yang ngajarin kamu sekuat ini?
Ada Pak Habibie katanya bikin.
Bikin pesawat
gitu.
Sim salabim.
Abrakadabra.
Singgobang gosir.
Pala botak gak bisa disisir.
Pala botak gak bisa.
Selamat malam pemirsa Si Today. Kita ketemu lagi di Ngonten ngobrolin tentang Nusantara.
Jadi gandring, Chris Empu Gandring.
Iya,
yeah,
itu dia.
Chris Empu Gandring. Jadi itu apa ini?
Dari mana? Kira menurut kamu ini daerah mana? Dari daerah mana? Dari negara lain ini?
Malaysia.
Dari China?
Bukan.
India?
Bukan. Asia Tenggara aja boleh gak? Namanya Si Today. Si Today itu Southeast Asian.
May the spirit of love, compassion and unity endure within and between us as we gather with friends and families to celebrate this festive period with laughter and cherished moments. Eid Mubarak to you all.
You ready to score a touchdown?
Oh, I was born ready.
Let's go.
Hello, you're watching See Today Updates at 2 p.m. with me, Ara Satya. Let's begin the first story where the Indonesian government humanitarian aid for Palestine arrived at the Cairo International Airport on Thursday after a 12-hour flight with Garuda Indonesia. The humanitarian aid delivery was instructed by Indonesian President Joko Widodo, who explained that it showed the commitment of the Indonesian government to maintain world peace and be involved in humanitarian mission due to war or disaster.
Hello and welcome back to the show. In case you just join us, welcome to our viewers in Indonesia and also across the world. Thank you so much for joining us on the 3-hour news show on Sea Today. Now we still have 2 more hours to bring you all the latest updates from Indonesia, Southeast Asia and also around the world. I'm your host for today, Hans Lango.
And I'm Hilyani Hidranto. Welcome to the 3-hour news show. Make sure you follow us on X, Instagram and YouTube at Sea Today News for the latest updates. And with us today is Karina for the latest from the business world.
Yes, thank you, Yani. Hi, I'm Karina Basrewan, and we'll be taking a look later on at the market and business updates from here in the country, the region, and elsewhere around the world. But for now, let's take a look at what made the top stories for today. Take it away, Hans.
On it. Several tourist destinations, including National Monument in central Jakarta, are crowded with visitors days after Eid celebration.
Religious and Islamic-themed movies are currently trending in Indonesia, drawing in over 1 million viewers and racking up millions of dollars in revenue.
In sports, Indonesian shuttlers Rinov Rivaldi and Pita Haningtyas Mentari are set to compete at the 2024 Paris Olympics after moving to the round of 16 of the Badminton Asia Championships.
And be sure to stay tuned later in our See the Series segment where we will learn how sound effects are made in movies with American Foley artist Sanaa Kelly. Stay tuned. And the first one coming from Indonesia, where Transportation Minister Budi Karya Sumadi made an inspection earlier this morning to Soekarno-Hatta International Airport ahead of the return flow of Eid homecoming season.
He predicted the peak of the return flow is likely to occur this coming Monday, with travelers exceeding to 1,236.
The inspection was held along the Terminal 1, where Minister Budi looked over the passenger traffic that will continue to surge upon the peak of the homecoming return flow.
The minister also expressed high appreciation to airport officials for their hard work and dedication to safeguard and take care of the passengers during the busiest period of the year. He said the number of passengers will hit its peak on Monday to reach around 190,000.
Bahwa movement itu sekarang sudah mencapai 1,236. Mendekati tahun 2019, 1,280. Surprise-nya adalah jumlah penumpangnya lebih besar. Kalau di Jakarta lebih besar 101% dibandingkan 2019 dan 104% di Bali. Nah, oleh karenanya tadi saya bicara dengan Kapolres, ini tidak mungkin terjadi kalau kita tidak melakukan kolaborasi. Semua sektor, AP, Airnav, lalu kepolisian, Bea Cukai, lalu imigrasi, terus juga Osman, airline, harus sama-sama saling mengisi. Ya. Saya hanya mengingatkan ya bahwa biasanya di mudik balik ini problemnya dia di bagasi.
Traffic congestion was seen along Sumedang Wado Highway on Thursday, a day after Idul Fitr.
Meanwhile, Puncak Bogor was packed with tens of thousands of vehicles, mostly heading towards Cianjur.
Now here's an aerial view of the traffic flow towards Puncak Bogor route earlier today. The line of vehicles stretched up to 3 kilometers. Most travelers were on their way to Cianjur for a family visit or vacation.
This jam pack is expected through Saturday and Sunday, coinciding with Eid written flow.
Hambatan utama di sepanjang jalur puncak itu adalah di simpang Pasir Puncak, kemudian simpang Megamendung. Tadi pada saat dilaksanakan one way, memang di dua persimpangan tersebut sudah terjadi antrian yang cukup panjang, sehingga untuk saat ini di masing-masing titik trouble spot utama atau titik kemacetan utama seperti Pasar Cisarua dan Simpang Taman Safari serta Gunung Mas, kami pertebal dengan personel dari Polres Bogor, Satsamapta maupun dari Satbrimob.
Data jumlah kendaraan yang terpantau kemarin?
Kalau untuk jumlah kendaraan memang kami masih rekap untuk saat ini. Namun untuk hari H+1 kemarin memang terpantau kendaraan yang menuju ke jalur puncak yang dari bawah menuju ke atas itu sejumlah 48.000 kendaraan.
Congestion was seen along the Sumedang Wado Highway on Thursday with the bottleneck seen at Warung Ketan intersection. The road has become a main route for tourists who are heading to Jati Gede Dam from downtown Sumedang.
The line stretched for hundreds of meters in both directions. Sumedang police have dispatched its personnel to assist a joint traffic control unit of police and armed forces.
And meanwhile, here in the capital city, several tourist destinations, including the Ragunan Zoo in South Jakarta, are still crowded with tourists days after Eid celebrations.
And elsewhere, a crowd of tourists was also seen at the National Monument in Gambir, Central Jakarta, earlier today.
The National Monument, or Monas, in Gambir, Central Jakarta, has become one of the popular tourist destinations among residents in Jakarta and other cities across Indonesia during holiday seasons. It is claimed as one of the best places to introduce the history of Indonesia to visitors. During Eid holidays, it is predicted that the number of visitors at the monument will continue to increase until Sunday.
Karena sekalian nganter anak tadi pulang ke Semarang, jadi mampir juga belum pernah ke Monas selama di Jakarta. Pengen naik ke atasnya. Nyaman ya, ternyata. Apa karena masih pagi, jadi nggak ramai banget.
From South Jakarta, a long queue of vehicles was seen along the entrance of Ragunan Zoo. Many tourists chose to visit the zoo, mainly due to its affordable tickets prices and educational tourism, where visitors, especially children, can learn more about animals.
Tiket, alhamdulillah di sini kan murah ya. Kita rombongan aja paling cuma nggak nyampe 100.000 paling. Rombongan sama keluarga. Udah gitu, jalurnya juga kalau lagi lebaran gini kan nggak macet gitu. Nggak enak.
Dari Bogor, Mas.
Kesini sama siapa?
Sama keluarga.
Bawa keluarga.
Bawa anak-anak juga sih kesini sama rame-rame. Daripada ke Bogor lagi ke kolam renang kan belum pernah kesini gitu, pengen lihat.
Ragunan Zoo authorities have prepared more facilities, including additional parking lots, to accommodate a surge in visitors. The zoo is now open from 7 a.m. during Eid holidays from April the 11th to 21st. Meanwhile, ticket costs 4,000 rupiah for adults and 3,000 rupiah for children. See Today contributors reporting from Jakarta.
And meanwhile, in Pandeglang, Banten, Anyer Beach and Carita Beach are filled with tourists who spent time to wind down during the Eid holidays.
Many people can also be seen swarming a newly opened water park in Karawang, West Java to cool off in a swimming pool situated amid the pine trees.
Hundreds of people can be seen cooling off in the swimming pool that is situated amid the pine trees in Karawang, West Java. The newly opened water park is crowded with visitors who are willing to queue in a long line to get in just because they didn't want to miss the holiday.
Lama banget, asli. Antriannya panjang banget, full. Padat. Ada hampir setengah jam lebih kayaknya. Agak lebih. Ya penasaran aja soalnya kan ini wisata baru ya. Baru kemarin buka dan hari ini hari kedua kali ya. Udah banyak banget ini pengunjungnya.
The water park management says that they expected a surge in visitors because this is about a whole new experience, a swimming amid the pine trees. Not only that, visitors can also indulge in all-terrain vehicle trails and cafe. Moreover, the management says during the grand launching day, the water park has seen more than 1,000 visitors.
Kita untuk opening tanggal 10 April 2024.
Baru kemarin ya Pak ya?
Iya, baru kemarin. Karena di sini itu Nemo memberikan tema untuk di Purwakarta itu, khususnya untuk di Bungur Sari, di sebuah hutan ada pantainya. Untuk akses sendiri kita langsung sih, nggak terlalu jauh dari jalan raya Bungur Sari. Paling sekitar 70-80 meter.
Meanwhile, in Pandeglang, Banten, Anyer Beach and Carita Beach are crowded with tourists who spend time to wind down during the Eid holidays. Visitors can be seen playing on the beach with sand, swimming along the shoreline, or just cooling off enjoying the panoramic views of the beach. One of the visitors say that they came here almost every year during the Eid holidays to wind down with their family.
2 jam lah. 2
jam ya.
3 jam ya. Paling lamanya 3 jam soalnya enggak macet.
Oh.
Kalau macet mah sekitar 4 jam 5 jam.
Oh, tadi lewat ini, lewat
Tak-tak.
Lewat Tak-tak kan Cerang ya.
Jalan baru soalnya. Ya, tempatnya juga eksotis ya, Om ya. Buat anak-anak juga ramai kan,
yeah.
Juga khawatir juga.
For those of you enjoying yourself on the beach, especially if you bring your little ones here, just take a good care of yourself and your kids. See Today contributor reporting from Banten.
Yes, the moment of Eid al-Fitr becomes the most awaited time to spend with your family and relatives.
That is certainly true, but for those of you who love to travel and explore foods during the holiday, you should visit Pulang Semarang Food Festival.
And for more information about the festival, let's connect with our news team Fahrian Bahri and Reza Anindita Ramadan live from Semarang Central Java. Hi Fahri, so what's the situation like out there?
Hi, good evening Yani and everyone who are watching See Today. For those of you culinary lovers who are living in Semarang Central Java or surrounding areas, who are, this information might be useful or might be an alternative one to spending time during Eid al-Fitr celebration. And for those of you who are kind of bored with typical food like coconut milk food, this will be an alternative because usually served when Eid al-Fitr celebration. So Festival Kuliner Pulang Semarang, or what we call in English is Back Home Semarang Food Festival, invites culinary lover to feel the sensation of authentic and appetizing food with more than 50 food kiosks. So I'm gonna take you closer to what's inside this food festival. So yeah, as you can see around me and behind me, more than a hundred of passengers are filled this food festival. And this culinary festival takes place from April 10th to 17th, 2024, located at Metro Point Kota Lama in Semarang Central Java. And this culinary festival is open to public and is free, actually. You can see left and right behind me, they are typical of Semarang specialties and popular Indonesian foods that being served in here. So if you are here, you will be presented with a variety of foods ranging from Semarang specialties as well as four popular dishes around Indonesia. So in the right side behind me, culinary specialties of Semarang are available, such as bakmi jowo, nasi goreng babat, and then lumpia, also nasi glowo. And meanwhile, for popular Indonesian food dishes such as gudeg from Yogyakarta, and then kue putu, soto, and then Palembang is also been here. So I'm gonna take you closer to one of my favorite street food. So it's left behind me. So it's called Kamar and Grilled Octopus. So there are a lot of people in here buying this Kamar and Grilled Octopus. So you only need to bring less than 100,000 rupiah to enjoy the variety of foods in this food festival. So yeah, that's all I can inform to you regarding the situation here in food festival in Semarang. So for those of you who are living in Semarang Central Java, don't forget to come to food festival Pulang Kampung Semarang, Pulang Kampung Semarang, or what we call in English is Back Home Semarang Food Festival in Semarang Central Java. Back to studio.
Okay, Fahri, before we let you go for your food adventure, we want to know what is the average price of these particular food festival?
Yeah, there are a lot of variety foods in this food and this festival, such as specialties from Semarang and then a favorite food around Indonesia. It's almost like a 15,000 rupiah until 50,000 rupiah. You can enjoy this variety food in this festival. So it's quite cheap over here, Hans.
Oh, well, that justifies.
I was gonna say, can we go there for dinner? Will we make it?
Oh, I don't know if we can make it. But that justifies your info that we can actually bring 100,000 rupiah to be able to satisfy and fulfill ourselves with those food. Fahri and Reza, thank you so much. And also, please be safe. We are waiting for you to come back to the office. Thank you so much. Yes, Yani, what do we have for the next one?
All right, so we're going to continue with our next story. This one is from Gaza, where more Palestinians returned to their heavily damaged homes in the central city of Khan Yunis in the Gaza Strip on Thursday.
And their return became possible after Israeli troops withdrew from the city, which is the second largest in the territory, on Sunday.
The residents found their home city unrecognizable, with thousands of buildings destroyed or damaged. Some buildings still stood, but were gutted, shelves scorched, and full of holes with partially shattered upper floors.
Among those who returned was Ishraf Kudeh, who spent the day clearing the rubble in what was left of her apartment. Despite the devastating destruction, she said it was better to be home than staying in a tent and, in this case, in a camp for the displaced.
Israel sent troops into Khan Yunis in December, part of its blistering ground offensive against Palestinian resistance. It claims the city was a major Hamas stronghold and that its operations there killed thousands of Palestinian civilians, including women and children.
نضل شوية في البيت لكن قعدنا فيه شوية يعني أحسن من المواصي وأحسن من الخيام والأجواء اللي إحنا فيها لسه يمكن عرادم بيوتنا أهول ما نقعد في مكان تاني
بعد حوالي 70 يوم نزوح في دير البلح قررت أن أرجع بعد ما هم انسحبوا اليوم طبعا قررت أن أرجع وألاقي هذا الدمار الهائل اللي موجود في البيت يعني البيت أصبح غير صالح إطلاقا للسكن فأنا قررت أن ما أرجعش على دير البلح
And from Gaza now, we're going to bring you to the eastern part of Indonesia, where Aradide Military Sector Commander 2nd Lieutenant Oktofian Sogare was fatally shot by an armed criminal group in Papua on Wednesday.
The commander was traveling to Pasar Putih village when the attack took place. Video footage uploaded by the armed criminal group showed the commander being shot while riding a motorbike. He was then attacked with sharp weapons as he fell to the ground.
Spokesperson for the Cendrawasih Military District Command, Lieutenant Colonel Chandra Kurniawan, has confirmed the victim's identity. He added that the victim's body was discovered day after the incident following a joint search by the police and armed forces. The body has been evacuated to Nabire.
Kita sangat menyesalkan kejadian penembakan yang dilakukan oleh OPM terhadap Dan Ramil di Kabupaten Paniai. Kita lihat sendiri di video itu sudah ditembak namun begitu tergeletak, tidak berdaya, masih dianiaya ya, sampai meninggal. Tentunya ini menjadikan catatan bagi kita yang selama ini OPM selalu berteriak menyampaikan pelanggaran HAM, tapi ternyata kita bisa lihat jadinya seperti itu. Meninggalnya ini diawali pada saat hari Rabu sore, almarhum keluar dari Koramil menuju ke kampung Pasir Putih, namun pada saat ditunggu sampai hari Kamis pagi tidak ada.
And on another note, Indonesian Armed Forces Commander General Agus Subianto welcomed the humanitarian aid team at Halim Perdana Kusuma Air Base in East Jakarta on Thursday after conducting a mission in Gaza, Palestine.
The commander also presented the Dharma Military Award of Defense to the team for completing their mission.
Indonesian Armed Forces Commander General Agus Subianto welcomed the humanitarian aid team at Halim Perdana Kusuma Air Base in East Jakarta after conducting a mission in Gaza, Palestine with the C-100J Super Hercules aircraft. He was accompanied by Air Chief Marshal Muhammad Tony Harjono, Army Chief General Maruli Simanjuntak, and Navy Chief Admiral Muhammad Ali. General Subianto also presented the Dharma Military Award of Defense to the team for completing their humanitarian mission. He added that the support and commitment of the armed forces aim to assist victims in Gaza who are experiencing food crisis. The humanitarian mission, which featured the team of Solidarity Path Operation, is expected to encourage other countries to send their humanitarian aid to Gaza. Led by Colonel Noto Kasnoto, the team sent 160 kilogram packages via a drop zone over Gaza's airspace during the 14-day mission. Each package contains food, medicines, and other necessities needed by the Palestinians. C2D the contributor reporting from East Jakarta.
And we're going for a quick break for this hour, but when we come back, we'll again have the latest from Southeast Asia and around the world.
And right after, I'll be back bringing you the latest from the world of business.
So, more reason for you to keep it right here on the 3-Hour News Show on CTV.
Selamat malam pemirsa, see you today. Kita ketemu lagi di Ngonten, ngobrolin tentang Nusantara. Dari gandrong gandring, Chris empuk gandring.
Iya,
yeah, itu dia. Tes
COVID. Jadi itu apa ini?
Dari mana? Kira menurut kamu ini dari mana? Dari daerah mana? Dari negara lain ini?
Malaysia.
Dari China?
Bukan.
India?
Bukan. Asia Tenggara aja boleh gak? Namanya C2Day. C2Day itu Southeast Asian.
Ke Binjai, mau migrasi.
Cakep.
Anjay, aku di Potsi.
Ya, aku cuma mau bilang hari ini kamu tuh cantik ya.
Aduh, ya Allah.
Oke lah kalau penampilan dia gak sebaik itu, gak sebagus itu, gak seganteng itu. Tapi itu hatinya dia sebaik itu dan tidak ada orang yang pernah gue temuin hatinya sebaik Mars.
Pemain!
Good morning Indonesia, Southeast Asia and the world. Rise and shine everyone. Back to our regular scheduled programming here on the C Morning Show. It is just past 6 in the a.m. And for the next 3 hours, myself along with my colleagues will be sharing with you all the latest news and updates from Indonesia and beyond. And time for your first sports update of the morning. We're going to begin with some updates from the world of football. We've got a talk show coming up as well and your latest viral news as well.
Welcome to City Day Business, your go-to source for the latest economic and business updates from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the globe.
Get ready for a power-packed show of insights, interviews, and analysis that will keep you ahead of the curve.
Join us Monday to Friday right at your lunch hour as we dive deep into the world of business, only on
City Day Business.
Hello, you're watching C2Day Updates at 2 p.m. with me, Aris Satya. Let's begin the first story where the Indonesian government humanitarian aid for Palestine arrived at the Cairo International Airport on Thursday after a 12-hour flight with Garuda Indonesia. The humanitarian aid delivery was instructed by Indonesian President Joko Widodo, who explained that it showed the commitment of the Indonesian government to maintain world peace and be involved in humanitarian mission due to war or disaster.
Kayaknya lucu juga nih kalau dapur kita kasih warna, nggak cuma warna coklat, warna putih, yang ternyata emang berhasil naikin mood rumah ini sih.
Untuk jendela, pintu, dan furniturnya semuanya harus simple dan minimalis.
Kalau misalnya bolongannya dari utara, itu pasti lebih banyak angin yang masuk.
Hello, welcome back to the show. Now we have some more updates or recommendation rather for you. If you're wondering where to spend your Eid holiday in Lampung, consider visiting Krakatau Park.
With its fascinating attractions, locals do not need to travel all the way to Dufan or Jatim Park anymore.
Now Aris Subakti and Hanif Abdu have all the details. Let's have a look.
Thank you so much and welcome to Krakatau Park, one of the biggest playground in Lampung. I'm currently in the middle of the park where 1,000 people are currently queuing around many rides and also attractions here. And this place has around 21 attractions that you can try with your family and friends. They have cable cars, science gallery, swimming pool, but the most favorite one here is the Mystery of Krakatau, one of the most popular volcano in Sumatra Island. And this place opened at 9 a.m. and closed at around 6 p.m. And to enter this place, you only have to pay 110,000 rupiah for cash transaction. But for cashless transaction, you only need to pay 100,000 rupiah only. And then if you are currently in Bakahuni Port or around Lampung, this place could be an option to spend your holiday. But if you are currently also boring waiting for your ship in Bakahuni Port, you only just need to walk here for 5 minutes. So this place also has some facilities such as food court, seafood resto, clinic restroom, and also souvenir shop. And then besides enjoying many attractions here, they also provide the live music and also traditional dance every day. So what are you waiting for? If you are currently having holiday around Lampung, this place probably can be an option. That's an update from Lampung. Back to studio.
Thank you so much, Arif and Hanif. Oh, that was certainly interesting.
Yeah, would you like to go?
If I have the chance to go to Lampung, but yeah. We have it here in Jakarta. And aside from a lot of festivities happening in Idul Fitri holiday, the Jakarta Lebaran Fair is also currently underway at the JE Expo Kemayoran. And what's the situation like over there? Joining with us live from the venue is our news team of Satya Pramesi and video journalist Dipta Adiwiguna. So Messi, looking very bright over there with all the lamps and lights. What's interesting about the festival?
Thank you, Hans. Thank you, Yani. Yes, we are at the Jakarta Lebaran Fair and GXPO Kemayoran. Now, this event is going to run, as you mentioned, or no, you didn't mention this actually, from April the 3rd to the 21st of April 2024. So just next week exactly on Sunday will be the last day for GXPO Lebaran, or I should say the Jakarta Lebaran Fair. So if you have nothing to do over the next week, I recommend maybe this is one of the places that you can go to. But I am currently in the entertainment area of the fair. So let's go take a look at what we can find over there. And while we do, we're going to have a conversation about what this place actually is. Because this little Lebaran Fair has the theme of exhibition, culinary delights, entertainment, and Ramadan month entertainment, such as this, for example, which is a merry-go-round with only one person on it at the moment. And we have another one as well over here. We have a proper merry-go-round over there and another thingy over there. Oops, I do apologize. Now, other than the entertainment section, the fair showcases domestic products from fashion and also from various industries, I should say, such as automotive, fashion, cosmetics, household equipment, furniture, electronics, electronics appliances, creative industries, banking, and services as well. Now, visitors can explore various products across multiple halls and open spaces such as this one with exclusive promotions and discounts as well. But alongside exhibitions, there are also traditional Indonesian delicacies, which you can see in the distance all the way over there, some of them in food trucks, others in stalls, but certainly quite a wide variety as well. Not only for to eat, but also to snack. And of course, at the time, when this first opened, it was still during Ramadan. So at the time, you can come here for iftar as well. But also, there also features a Lebaran Fair music concert with daily performances by some favorite musicians from Indonesia and bands at 20:30 Waktu Indonesia Barat, so about 2 hours from now. But speaking of entertainment, I've got one thing I need to do while we're doing the live, because I kind of really want to win this, win these dolls, or win a doll for my fiancé. Let's see if we can get it.
Hello, my wife. Selamat malam, selamat datang di rumah Midway. Di rumah unik terdapat berbagai macam permainan, seperti Smash the Plan ya kakak ya. Di sini cara bermainnya adalah kakak akan diberikan 3 sak ini ke kaleng-kaleng yang ada di sini. Kakak harus menjatuhkan semua kaleng yang ada di sini ya. Kaleng-kaleng tersebut harus jatuh semuanya di luar kotak coklat ya kakak ya. Jika pada kesempatan pertama kakaknya berhasil, kakak akan mendapatkan boneka yang atas. Jika pada kesempatan kedua kakaknya berhasil, kakak akan mendapatkan boneka yang kedua. Jika kakak pada kesempatan ketiga berhasil, kakak akan mendapatkan boneka yang ini atau yang ini. Tapi cara bermainnya, kakak cara melemparkan sak ke kaleng-kaleng ini harus berada di belakang garis kuning ini ya kakak ya.
Behind this yellow line, okay.
Garisnya itu tidak boleh diinjak ya kakak ya. Kalau diinjak, nanti kakak hadiahnya angus seperti itu ya.
Oke,
terima kasih kakak. Ada juga permainan lainnya kakak ya, seperti...
Kita coba ya.
Kakak mau coba, boleh banget nih ya kakak ya. 3 kali kesempatan ya kakak ya, di belakang garis kuning. Silakan mencoba, semoga beruntung.
Right, here we go. We're gonna see if I am as good.
Oke, okay, ayo kakak kita beri semangat untuk kakaknya yang bermain. Yuk! Woo! Satu, dua, tiga. Ayo kakak, semangat. Iya, sayang sekali kakak yang masih kurang beruntung. Dua kali kesempatan lagi. Yuk, bisa yuk. Iya, aduh, sayang banget kakak ya. Kurang atasan kali ya kakak ya, pelemparnya ya. Oke, satu kali kesempatan lagi.
You know, you win some, you lose some. Unfortunately, I lost this one.
Okay, but anyway,
this is one of the many things you can do in the Jakarta Lebaran Fair. I hope you guys can find the time to come here. Yeah, back to you guys in the studio.
Messi, oh my God, we were rooting for you.
That was
you
so close.
You could only see in the studio and also the control room when you threw out of the lane. We were like, ah! Oh. But anyway, please enjoy your time over there. And we are certainly waiting for you to be back to the studio and also the office. Thank you so much.
That was so much fun. I want to do it too.
Yeah, but one thing that I've been wondering, how did she breathe?
Oh yeah.
She was like, I keep on citing all those regulations and pretty fast. But actually, that was fun. We hope that you could go there if you do have time during this holiday season. And now the next one, homecoming trip has been an annual tradition among Indonesians during each holiday, but some chose to stay at home to travel around the city, which is Jakarta.
That's right. Now, to accommodate tourists in Jakarta, TransJakarta is extending the operational hour of its double-decker tourist bus from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m.
Eid homecoming has become a tradition among Indonesians, especially those residing in Jakarta. However, some chose to spend their holidays here in the capital. To accommodate local residents and tourists, Jakarta's double-decker tourist bus, known as Jakarta Explorer, is extending its operational hour during the holidays. The bus is now operating from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., starting from April the 11th to the 15th, from its original operating hour from 10 p.m. to 5 p.m. There are two types of double-decker buses, namely the regular bus with a full roof and another one with an open roof on the second deck, allowing tourists to enjoy the weather of Jakarta.
Oh, it's such a beautiful day, isn't it? So I'm currently at this double-decker bus where I'm currently sightseeing across the city of Jakarta. And there's the icon behind me, which is the Cathedral Church. So with this bus, you can go sightseeing across the landmarks and the icons that's very historical in the city of Jakarta. And this bus is currently operating since 9 a.m. up until 5 p.m.
The double-decker buses also serve four routes during the holidays. The BW1 route takes tourists to historic places across Jakarta, including Istiqlal Mosque and Bank Indonesia Museum, while the BW2, which features the theme of New Jakarta, traverses National Museum to Istiqlal Mosque. Meanwhile, the BW4 route explores Jakarta's iconic skyscrapers through Sudirman Road. Last but never the least, the BW9 route travels around Pantai Indah Kapuk areas.
So using this double-decker bus, you can hop on and hop off at any bus stop that you want, and you can pick whichever landmark or icon that you want to visit. And I think I would like to visit the National Monument, and it is right here. So I'm going to stop here at the National Monument. And what's more important is that using this bus, you can travel for free as long as you bring your electronic card money. Maudie Kalisha and Dipta Diwiguna for City Today.
And
National Monument is just across the street, so maybe we should go there too.
Probably, and I'm so happy that all of our news team got the brown outfit memo. I love that.
Love it. All right, we're going for another break.
And after the break, Karina will deliver some economics and business updates, so let's welcome her back in.
I got the brown memo.
Oh, you do?
Definitely.
And how is business these days?
Yes, we've got updates on the Argentinian interest rates and also how Indonesian movies are actually making the banks.
Ooh.
Yes, that's some good news right there. So we'll be taking a look at some business updates from Indonesia and beyond right here on the 3-Hour News Show right after the break. Stay with us.
Absolutely delicious.
You know, it's actually pretty good.
Satu, dua, tiga.
Come see the nature, only on See Indonesia.
Come see the beauty, only on See Indonesia.
Only on See Indonesia.
Ready to score a touchdown?
Oh, I was born ready.
Let's go.
Let's go.
Go.
Gua yang penting apa yang gua makan bisa gua buang pada saat olahraga sih gitu.
Jadi Abilau kalau ketemu mungkin dia ketawa. Gitu.
Dengan proses, gue bersyukur banget Kubu Junior tuh sempat bubar tahun 2016-2017.
Pilihnya sabu-sabu, karena sabu-sabu kita cuma makannya setahun sekali.
Kalau kita dengerin Spotify, Pak gimana sih caranya aku bisa masuk di sini sedikit? Ya nggak boleh menghalangi lah.
Figur publik kok kere?
Perlombaan ini tuh seperti mendaki Everest 3 kali.
Gitu. Apa sih yang dicari? Bini setuju aja?
Harus setuju, saya jadi badut.
Siapa sih yang ngajarin kamu sekuat ini?
Ada Pak Habibie katanya gitu, bikin.
Bikin pesawat?
Bikin pesawat gitu.
Simsalabim.
Simsalabim.
Abrakadabra.
Abrakadabra.
Singgobangkosir.
Singgobangkosir.
Pala botak nggak bisa disisir.
Pala botak nggak bisa.
Selamat malam pemirsa, see you today. Kita ketemu lagi di Ngonten, ngobrolin tentang Nusantara. Jadi gandrong, gandring, Chris empuk gandring.
Iya, itu dia. Chris empuk gandring. Amin ya. Apa ini?
Dari mana? Kira menurut kamu ini daerah mana? Dari daerah mana? Dari negara lain ini?
Malaysia.
Dari China?
Bukan.
India.
Asia Tenggara aja boleh gak? Namanya See Today Southeast Asian.
Welcome back to the 3-Hour News Show. If you have just joined us, we are now entering our economics segment and we have some updates to share with you. And our first order of business comes from Argentina, where the central bank recently have cut its interest rate and is expected to reduce inflation in the future. The bank announced on Thursday that it has cut its benchmark interest rate by 10% from 80 to 70%. This move underscored the government confidence over bringing down inflation since August 2023 that reached 276.2% annually in February of 2024. The bank is seeing pronounced slowdown in inflation despite the strong statistical drag that the inflation carries
in its monthly averages after the initial correction of relative prices in December 2023. The government previously expected that inflation will fall from its peak of 25% in December 2023 to nearly 10% in March 2024, following a sharp currency devaluation by President Javier Milei. This is the third adjustment after President Milei took office in December 2023. His tight fiscal policies have boosted the mood of investors in Argentina, propelling shares and bonds, although poverty levels are increasing along with an economic recession. An update from Tesla. The company has taken back its crown as the world's largest seller of electric vehicles after Chinese EV maker BYD recorded a drop in sales in the first quarter. BYD sales fell by 43% compared to the fourth quarter of last year. The Chinese EV giant sold 300,114 EVs, which was significantly lower than the over 526,000 EVs they sold in the previous quarter. As a result, Tesla took back its title as the world's largest seller of EVs. The American company delivered over 386,000 electric cars in the first quarter. However, this was 8.5% lower than the same period of last year and Tesla's first year-over-year decline in sales since the pandemic. And right here from Indonesia, the film industry has made history in 2023, where 20 local films each broke the 1 million viewers, marking the highest achievement in over a decade.
Each of the 20 Indonesian films managed to attract more than 1 million viewers in 2023. Data from filmindonesia.or.id indicated that this is the highest achievement in the last 11 years, ranging from 2013 to 2023. Horror film titled Suudino was in first place with more than 4,800,000 viewers. It was followed by another horror film titled The Ambang Kematian with more than 3,300,000 viewers. It means that those 20 films reached a total of more than 40,472,000 viewers. If the movie ticket were priced at 35,000 rupiah, the revenue generated in 1 year alone would exceed more than 1.4 trillion rupiah. The achievement of 20 domestic films with each hitting over 1 million viewers in 2023 is a positive sign for the Indonesian film industry. Thus, to support its growth, Cinema XX1 plans to add 100 new screens across Indonesia in 2024.
Kalau mau diajari nyanyi, gimana kalau manggilnya ibu?
Meanwhile, religious and Islamic-themed movies have also been a hit here in Indonesia, with at least 8 such films drawing in over 1 million viewers and racking up millions of dollars in revenue.
Kalau Mbak yang tetap ingin mengambil Baskara dari kami, akan banyak hati yang hancur di rumah ini.
Indonesian religious Islamic-themed films have quietly captivated hearts of million viewers. At least 8 films have more than 1 million viewers each. Topping the list is a 2008 Ayat Ayat Cinta with over 3.6 million viewers, generating revenue of 107 billion rupiah. Following closely is Air Mata di Ujung Sajadah with over 3.1 million viewers. In the third place, Ayat Ayat Cinta 2 collected more than 2.8 million viewers and exceeded 104 billion rupiah in revenue.
Ada banyak tokoh perempuan hebat dalam perkembangan sejarah Islam.
Despite horror movies dominating the local cinema, these successes shows a strong appeal of Islamic-themed films in Indonesian cinema.
Tidak masalah, penjelasan Anda bagus.
The aforementioned 8 movies alone boast over 17 million viewers, and Ayat Ayat Cinta currently ranks 13th in the top 100 most viewed Indonesian films of all time.
And that wraps up all the economic and business updates that we have for you for this evening. We're due for another short break, but when we return, Yani will be coming back to update you from the world of sports. Stay with us.
Ke Binjai, mau migrasi.
Cakep.
Anjay, aku depot sih.
Aku cuma mau bilang hari ini kamu tuh cantik loh.
Aduh ya Allah. Kalau ini.
Oke lah kalau penampilan dia enggak sebaik itu, enggak sebagus itu, enggak seganteng itu, tapi tuh hatinya dia sebaik itu dan tidak ada orang yang pernah gue temuin hatinya sebaik Mars.
Pemain.
Good morning, Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and the world. Rise and shine, everyone. Back to our regular scheduled programming here on the C Morning Show. It is just past 6 in the a.m. And for the next 3 hours, myself along with my colleagues will be sharing with you all the latest news and updates from Indonesia and beyond. And time for your first sports update of the morning. We're going to begin with some updates from the world of football. We've got a talk show coming up as well and your latest viral news as well.
Welcome to City Day Business, your go-to source for the latest economic and business updates from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the globe.
Get ready for a power-packed show of insights, interviews, and analysis that will keep you ahead of the curve.
Join us Monday to Friday right at your lunch hour as we dive deep into the world of business, only on
City Day Business.
Hello, you're watching C Today Updates at 2 p.m. with me, Ares Satya. Let's begin the first story where the Indonesian government humanitarian aid for Palestine arrived at the Cairo International Airport on Thursday after a 12-hour flight with a Garuda unit. The humanitarian aid delivery was instructed by Indonesian President Joko Widodo, who explained that it showed the commitment of the Indonesian government to maintain world peace and be involved in humanitarian mission due to war or disaster.
Absolutely delicious.
You know, it's actually pretty good.
Satu, dua, tiga.
Indonesia! Come see the nature, only on See Indonesia.
Come see the beauty, only on See Indonesia.
Only on See Indonesia.
Viewers, my name is Liani Hidranto and you're still watching the 3-hour news show on See Today. All right, so now let's start the sports segment with great news from badminton. Indonesian shuttlers Rino Frivaldi and Pita Haningtyas Mentari are set to compete at the 2024 Paris Olympics after advancing to the round of 16 of the 2024 Badminton Asia Championships. Frivaldi and Mentari, however, failed to reach the quarterfinals after losing to South Korea's So Jong-jae and Cha Yung-jung 18-21 and 14-21. The pair secured their tickets to the multi-sporting event after their opponents in the top 16 race to Paris match, namely Singapore's Hee Yong-kai Terry and Tan Wei Han Jessica, and fellow Indonesian mixed doubles pair Dejan Ferdiansyah and Gloria Emmanuel Wijaya were eliminated in the round of 16. So from badminton, two Indonesian men single players are through to the quarterfinals of Badminton Asia Championship 2024 in Ningbo, China. But on the women's side, Gregoria Mariska Tunjung is the only Indonesian player left. Two Indonesian men's singles players, Anthony Sinisuka Ginting and Jonathan Christie, have advanced to the quarterfinals of the Badminton Asia Championship 2024. At the Ningbo Olympic Sports Center Gymnasium, China, Anthony Ginting defeated Somi Romdani of the United Arab Emirates 21-9, 21-10, and in 31 minutes. The other quarterfinal spot went to Jonathan Christie, who saw the challenge from Hong Kong's Lee Chuk-yu in straight games 21-14 and 21-16. Meanwhile, only one Indonesian women's singles player remained. Gregoria Mariska Tunjung advanced to the quarterfinals after defeating Pai Yo Po of Taiwan. Tunjung was down 7-11 in the first game and managed to turn it around and win it 21-19. And she booked her place in the quarters after winning the second game 21-16. And now we're going to leave badminton for a little bit because we have football updates for you. Ahead of the AFC Under 23 Asian Cup 2023, the Indonesian squad arrived in Qatar Wednesday evening. Straight away, Coach Shin Tae-yong held a training session for the team in preparation for their match against host Qatar on April 15th.
The Indonesian squad have arrived in Qatar ahead of the AFC Under 23 Asian Cup 2024. Without wasting a lot of time, straight away, Coach Shin Tae-yong held the first training session at the Abdullah bin Khalifa Training Stadium in Doha. Although it was only for physical recovery, the young Garuda team trained hard to get their synergy right in preparation for their opening match against the host nation, Qatar, on April the 15th.
Latihannya tidak terlalu berat, latihan ringan, tapi tetap fokus dan kerja keras. Dan coaching staff juga memberikan pesan dan motivasi untuk kita bisa sampai final nanti. Untuk persiapan khusus sih pastinya ada ya. Untuk kita juga saling support satu sama lain dan ya kiper pasti berusaha lebih lagi.
The Indonesian team are in Qatar after a 10-day training camp in the United Arab Emirates during which the young Garuda played two trial matches. Indonesia lost 3-1 to Saudi Arabia and won 1-0 against UAE.
We still have one more update for you. Let's move on to tennis. Host Australia moved to within a victory of reaching the Billie Jean King Cup Finals after sweeping both opening matches of their qualifier tie with Mexico in Brisbane on Friday. Arina Rodionova recovered from a set down to defeat Juliana Olmos in the opening clash 3-6, 6-3, 6-1 to give Australia a 1-love lead. Daria Savier then dispatched Marcela Zacharias in straight sets 6-1, 6-love in the second singles on Friday to give Australia a 2-love lead heading into Saturday's final day of the tie. Savia was playing in place of Storm Hunter, who suffered an ankle injury in practice on Thursday and now faces a prolonged spell on the sidelines. The seven-time champions Australia need one win on Saturday to advance to November's finals. Australia are seeking its first Billie Jean King Cup since 1974. Alrighty then, that's a wrap for sports for now. But when we return, we'll have more information, including our signature segment, See the Stories. So keep it right here on the 3-Hour News Show on See Today.
Kayaknya lucu juga nih kalau dapur kita kasih warna, nggak cuma warna coklat, warna putih, yang ternyata emang berhasil naikin mood rumah ini sih.
jendela, pintu, dan furniturnya semuanya harus simple dan minimalis.
Kalau misalnya bolongannya dari utara, itu pasti lebih banyak angin yang masuk.
Ready to score a touchdown?
Oh, I'm born.
Let's go.
Let's go.
Go.
Gua yang penting apa yang gua makan bisa gua buang pada saat gua olahraga, segitu.
Jadi Abilau kalau ketemu mungkin dia ketawa gitu.
Dengan proses, gue bersyukur banget Kubu Junior tuh sempat bubar tahun 2016-2017.
Pilihnya sabu-sabu, karena sabu-sabu kita cuma makannya setahun sekali.
Kalau kita dengerin Spotify, apa gimana sih caranya aku bisa masuk di sini gitu-gitu. Ya nggak boleh menghalangi lah.
Figur publik kok kere.
Perlombaan ini tuh seperti mendaki Everest 3 kali.
Gitu. Apa sih yang dicari? Bini setuju aja?
Harus setuju, saya jadi batu.
Siapa sih yang ngajarin kamu sekuat ini?
Ada Pak Habibie katanya gitu, bikin.
Bikin pesawat?
Bikin pesawat gitu.
Simsalabim!
Simsalabim!
Abrakadabra!
Abrakadabra!
Singgobangkosir!
Singgobangkosir!
Pala botak gak bisa disisir!
Pala botak gak bisa!
Kebinjai, mau migrasi.
Cakep!
Anjay, aku di pot sih.
Aku cuma mau bilang hari ini kamu tuh cantik loh.
Aduh ya Allah. Baru kali ini.
Oke lah kalau penampilan dia gak sebaik itu, gak sebagus itu, gak seganteng itu. Tapi tuh hatinya dia sebaik itu dan tidak ada orang yang pernah gue temuin hatinya sebaik Mars.
Pemain.
At Mubarak, di protek kami cinta tekan terus negasion cinta dari tangga. ការកានីដែរនេះខ្ញុំសូមជូនពរអរដល់លោកស្រីអ្នកនាងកញ្ញាជួបតែសេចក្ដីសុខសេចក្ដីចម្រើនធ្វើដំណើរប្រកបដោយសុវត្ថិភាពអេតមូបារ៉ាក់ទូយូអលអឺ
Hello and welcome back to the 3-hour news show on CS Today. Now for the next hour, we'll bring you the latest stories and our See the Story segment. And you're still with me, Hans Lionel.
And I'm Hiliani Hidranto. For the latest updates, you can also follow us on Instagram, X, and YouTube at See Today News. And also with us,
I'm Karina Bastroyan. But before anything else, let's see what's making headlines today. Hans?
Thank you so much, Karina. Several tourist destinations, including National Monument in central Jakarta, was so crowded with visitors days after Eid celebrations.
Religious and Islamic-themed movies are currently trending in Indonesia, drawing in over a million viewers and racking up millions of dollars in revenue.
In sports, Indonesian shuttlers Rino Frivaldi and Pita Haningtyas Mentari are set to compete at the 2024 Paris Olympics after moving to the round of 16 of the Badminton Asia Championships.
And now in just a minute, stay tuned to our See the Story segment. We will learn how sound effects are made in movies with American Foley artist Sana Kelly. Stay tuned.
Hello and welcome back to the 3-hour news show. You are still watching our signature segment, See the Story. Now we're gonna let the other hosts take a little break, and I'm gonna take over. I am your host, Hathi Permesi. And I don't know about you guys, but I love watching movies and series, and I've just realized sometimes there are a lot of people working on it to make sure that the movie or series becomes successful. Now, one of them are Foley artists, and they are in charge of doing sound effects for the film itself. Now, joining us is one of them, California-based Sana Kelly, a Foley artist and founder of Real Foley Sound.
to share about her journey as a Foley artist. Well, first of all, good afternoon, or I should say good evening to you. I keep saying that wrong. Good evening, Sana, and thanks for joining us on today's interview. First of all, can you tell us a little bit about what a Foley artist does during the filming process? Perhaps because a lot of our viewers might not be so familiar with your job.
Well, hello, and thank you for having me. Foley, the best way to explain it is the performed part of sound. So all the footsteps, hand touches, when people are eating, drinking, they write, everything is done by a Foley artist. And depending on the budget, we tend to do things that are a little bit more sound effect-y, but like usually the sound effects, for example, if someone gets into the car, we do the hand on the car, the sit, the keys, but the actual motor sound, that's sound effects. So there's like a fine line between what's Foley, what's sound effects.
Right, so I didn't realize there was a difference between sound effects and Foley, but Foley is where you directly record it, right?
You actually are performing it as it's happening. Like if I was an actor, like you have to predict what the actor is gonna do, and you're gonna match it, like miking, distance, and so you're not like just getting the sound and cutting it. You're doing it as it's happening, and you're performing it. Like if someone is sad and they're doing footsteps, you gotta act out the sound as if they're sad.
Okay.
You know. If I'm drinking a soda, like I'm actually following the actor, how much of the soda they drink. So as I'm doing the slosh of it, I'm doing less and less of the soda. So it is actually the performing part of it. If you see some of my videos, you see me when I'm allowed to share the screen, you could see that I'm actually doing what they're doing as they're doing it in perfect timing.
Right, I see. So can I ask why it's important for the sound to be that crisp? Like, is it that different compared to having the sound recorded directly on set?
That is a very, very good question. I asked the same one when I started 29 years ago. Okay. Why are we doing this? Like, I'm like, aren't they using the production sounds? Like, I'm like, are they not like recording? Are they falling asleep? What's going on? So basically, when they say quiet on the set, they are making the set quiet. They are more focusing on getting the performance and the dialogue of the actors. Okay. So let's say, for example, if I'm an actor and I'm talking, I'm eating potato chips. You know, the bag of the crisps, the potato right. chips, is very crinkly. So the microphone will pick that out louder than actually my dialogue. So then I have to go in and redo my lines in a studio, which is called ADR. But you really want the actual performance of the actor. That's what they're trying to get. Also, if I get a wrench and I get in the head with it, get hit in the head, you're actually not gonna hit an actor with a real wrench and break their head.
Yeah.
They have a prop that looks like a wrench, but when you hit it, it's not gonna hurt them. So because they know we're gonna actually fix it in post-production sound when we do Foley. And also, that. Like, footsteps, if I'm everything. Walking and I have high heels and I'm talking and walking, the high heels are going to sound louder than my dialogue. So you're not going to be able to hear clean dialogue. So this is one part of it. Let's say they were able to get really good dialogue and the production sound was good. It's not going to be clean throughout. So they're going to have to replace some of it. Or when they take it to a foreign market and they strip out the original language and they put a different language. If I'm talking and clapping, now it's good, right?
Right.
But then they remove the English, the clapping is going to go with it. So my mouth will be moving a different language and there's no sound with the claps. So that's why it's important. They use it for the foreign and actually the domestic as well.
I see. That's really interesting. Now, you mentioned that you asked that same question when you first started out in Foley. So what actually sparked your interest in to become a Foley artist? And or was there a kind of like a specific encounter or instance that made you like, yes, I want to give that a try?
Well, actually, I went to school. I have my biology degree and master's in business. And I went to med school for a couple years. That was always my goal, that when I was right off high school, I went to a studio and I saw a Foley artist working. I'm like, I asked that question and they gave me that explanation. I'm like, oh my gosh, I'm a total overachiever. I was walking, I was like one before I was one, so I can totally do this. Put me in front of the mic, I couldn't do it. Like, you know, you have to do heel toe. You have to make it sound natural in front of the mic. You can't walk forward because they're gonna capture it nice and clean, you know, and louder than it should be, because once you add music, once you add backgrounds, dialogue, it's just gonna get swallowed. You're not gonna hear it. So you have to be bigger than life, you know? So I couldn't do it. I couldn't get sync, because then you see their feet, then you see their torso, then it goes back and forth, the camera angles, and you have to be able to catch the cuts. I just couldn't do it. And, you know, he told me, it's okay. Some people have it, some people don't. You just don't have it. Mm. And, you know, you can't challenge me. So, of course, I called every studio and I got a gazillion no's. And one studio let me sit in, but they said I cannot sit in with the Foley artist. They didn't want to teach. Right. So you can't learn from them. You could sit with the Foley mixer, which they actually did me a favor, because I learned how to use my ears and get like creative. And, you know, fast forward a few years ago, I went ahead and opened TikTok and Instagram, because I want people that are trying to learn, can I make life a little bit easier on them? You know, so here I am 29 years later, I'm doing it fully.
So how long did it take you to, you know, all the way from you when you first began, when you first kind of came into that, let's not call it a set, but let's call it a working area for Foley artists, and you first listened to it, all the way until you were able to, let's say, do it absolutely perfect every time. How long did that process take for you to finally get it right?
Well, I faked it a lot. I pretended that I knew what I was doing. So with me, it took me a little longer and a lot of trial and error, because I did not know, no one was teaching me how to do stuff. Like, for example, I didn't even know what to use for grabs. I didn't know what to use for stuff. You know, like I know now you could use hay, you could use the Easter grass, you could actually use actual grass, but it gets thumpy. I didn't know all that stuff. So it's years and years of trial and error. So it took me a few years to get okay. I don't think you're ever perfect in this job. It's, I feel like I'm constantly learning and striving to be better.
Right.
Perfect. When you say you're perfect, then you're done. You could just like hang the towel and go, right? But I feel like I'm always learning. Even the people that I trained, I learned from them too. They have a different technique. I'm like, oh, that was kind of cool. What did you do? You know, so yeah. For the normal person, it takes a few years. I had someone that I trained that she was good with like a year and a half. Like, you know, she still asks questions. I mean, she could work, but I think for the normal person, it takes 3 to 6 years. Mm-hmm. Because it is timing, it was about miking, it's about, you know, like getting, so you could do it and sound like a robot, you know, within the first few years, but then you gotta get the performed part. You gotta, you know, you don't wanna sound like it's Foley. You know you did a good job when people don't know our job even exists. It's natural.
Yeah, I totally get what you mean. And it's funny you mentioned earlier how you use different types of, what was it, hay, just to make the sound of someone walking on grass. And I find that really interesting, because I've seen a lot of your videos, and I've seen a lot of videos of other Foley artists as well who are doing their art, right? First of all, why are the reference sounds so different than what we actually see? Like, sometimes I see someone, you know, using a cheese grater to make the sound of like someone hitting a piece of metal or something. Why is it so different than what we actually see? Like, why are the tools that you use so different than what we're actually seeing on, let's say, the set, if you will?
So it's not about what it looks like. It's about what it sounds like. So if it sounds right, then it's right. You know, I think that's the best. Sometimes we go what we call, we go method. We use the actual prop. Sometimes we know like this will sound like a coconut filled with stuff in a certain way. It's gonna sound like a horse hoof. You know, we're not gonna get a horse and tell it to do Foley. You know, we get gloves and put, like if I have, you know, I did like Clifford the Bitterack dog years ago. And, you know, like I have gloves and I have like for different dog, different size, I have different things for them. For Clifford, he didn't get any nails for, like, he just big pads for smaller dogs. I put glove with like paper, what is that, paper clips. Other ones got nails, other ones got fake nails. So I wanted all my dogs to sound different. So they're dogs, but depending on size, I make them sound heavier, bigger, thinner nails, all that stuff. So I'm not gonna have a dog and tell him, hey, okay, let's go do the Foley. So you have to fake it. And you have to make it bigger than life. So if someone is going like this and it's a story point, like I'm gonna do it bigger. So if I'm talking, like if you add dialogue, they add a room tone. Like if I'm in a room and there's a fan, they add the room, they add the sound of the fan, they add the sound off. If the windows open, they do like street sounds and stuff. The sound effects will do that. And then there's music, right? So you add all that. If I'm doing natural sound this little, you're not gonna hear anything. So I have to do it bigger. And then when the dubbing mixer is mixing it, they decide how much Foley they can push, how much music they can push. They level it all to see. That's why it's always bigger than it's supposed to be. I mean, on my videos, I sound like crazy Godzilla running around, but it's for a reason.
Right, yeah, I totally get what you mean. It's about making the sound that the audience can intuitively expect, right, from those things that are happening on screen, or just from even little things like a fan spinning in the room. So I'm curious, what's the weirdest item you've used to make a particular sound?
Oh my gosh, I use weird items every day of my life. The other day I was with, so the note was, we're doing kissing scenes. They said they want a normal scene and no more kissing, and they want an over the top kissing. I'm like, you know, they're like, no, and I'm like, no. So I'm like, my Foley partner that was with me working for me today, my coworker, I'm like, okay, man, get an orange. So as I'm kissing, he's going, eating an orange, that's kissing. Zombies, smashing heads, eating ribs and stuff, you know? So obviously I'm not gonna start smashing heads and stuff. So we got like a watermelon and smashed it, and they were eating brain. So we got our hands in there and we're smooshing them. I don't know if I posted the video yet. And when they were eating the ribs, they were like literally kept eating the ribs. So I used like celery to do like some of the crunchiness, and you know, we added different layers of chamois. I added some lasagna for the smaller bones cracking, like raw lasagna. So there's, I mean, how many years do you have to tell you the weird things I use?
Yeah, I can imagine there must be quite a lot. Would you say there's been a film that was the most challenging because it required kind of almost like a turning over, if you will, of your instinct as a Foley artist?
Absolutely. The latest show that we've worked on is Shogun. It challenged everything in my life. The thing was, it's such a beautiful series and everything is done for a purpose, and it's Japanese. So I had to buy, and they wanted authenticity. It had to be authentic. So I had to go buy tatami mat, and I'll do the footsteps. And then later on, I see that I'm going against the grain when they're going with the grain. So I have to do all of them again. I'm trained to do heel-toe, but they shuffle their feet and they have the socks like with the toe thing, you know? And then the outfits they were wearing, I have to match them. Then I had to do like all the people, they have different gear on, I have to do it. And I bought the actual swords, katanas? Yeah, I had to buy, even when they were making the tea ceremony, like the actual, like I couldn't fake it because it's such a unique sound. And everything is so precise and perfect and like on screen. So you had nowhere to hide. You had to be absolutely perfect, you know? It was really challenging. And I have to say it was like really rewarding, because you know, sometimes you get bored doing everyday things. I just love a good challenge.
Yeah, I can imagine. It must have felt very satisfying when you did that and it came out exactly the way you wanted to, right?
Oh yeah, and then you watch it on Hulu now, and you know they had Greg Russell. He's the one that mixed the Foley and effects, and he's like, he has a gazillion Oscar nominations and stuff. So to have him mix it and then listen to it on TV was like, okay, that was so worth it.
I mean, you yourself, you've won awards as well, haven't you? You've won Emmys, I think four times.
I have not won Emmys. I was nominated.
You were nominated for Emmys.
Maybe this one will give it to us.
Hopefully soon, yeah.
Oh God, let's do it.
would you say being nominated has been your proudest moment so far? Or is there something to do with kind of what you did with Shogun, where it completely turned everything you know basically about being a Foley artist that you felt to be the most proud moment of your career so far?
You know, that's really interesting because I feel really proud. So here's my thing always. Let's say you have a filmmaker, you have directors, producers, camera people, like sound people, you have people that invest their money, right? So all these people, actors and everyone collectively made their masterpiece that have spent millions of dollars on them, right? Millions, like even the lower budget ones, but even the bigger budgets, right? Any budget. So they dedicate so much of their time, their money, their artistry to create their masterpiece. And of all the Foley artists out there in the world, they chose me. So every project that they give me, it is my proudest project. And I feel so, I don't know, proud that they chose me. So I can't say being nominated is my proudest moment. Every project I get is my proudest moment.
That sounds like a really healthy way to approach your life. I feel like that way, you know, every time you have a new project, that's always, you're always happy with it. Would you say you had a project that you felt, or perhaps a team that you always feel like it's always a good team to work with?
So right now I've been doing Foley for 29 years. I have a lot of clients. I have my own company. I have 3 Foley stages. Everyone I work with, I like. If I don't like them, they're not good human beings. I tell them, I'm not working for you. I don't like you. Be a better human. Maybe I'll work with you. Actually, I won't.
Is that kind of like your key to ensuring that the business and the work kind of works well?
Well, I just feel like why surround myself with people that are negative or unhappy with their life? Why would I bring that to my life? I love what I do. I'm not gonna allow them to ruin it for me. If I take a job and the person happens to be horrible halfway through the job, I will do everything I can to ensure that they're happy. I will give them the project exactly the way they want it. And I will do any crazy pickups they have, no problem. But I will tell them at the end, are you happy? They say, yes. Is there anything else I could do for you? They'll say, yes. I'm like, well, you could do something for me. Don't ever call me again.
All right, well, while we're on that subject, do you have a specific producer or director that you've always wanted to work with?
All of them.
All of them, every single one.
Of course I want to work on all the cool projects. So it's hard for me to say because I have some friends that work with certain directors and producers that I rather not say because I don't like to step on people's toes. We all want to work on a really cool project. We all do, you know? So it's like, and we get excited. We're so nerds.
Yeah, and so what's next for you in career? Do you have any upcoming projects or goals that you're excited about perhaps?
I actually have something pretty cool coming up. I created a TV show that's around Foley, and we have Paris Hilton's company and Project X Entertainment that are working with us executive producers. So yeah, we're gonna see where we go with that. So we're very excited.
Have you decided for a name for it yet? So we can kind of find out when it comes out.
I don't know if I'm allowed to say.
Oh no!
I don't know. I have to ask. I didn't ask ahead of time.
Okay, well, don't worry, because whenever it does come out, we are definitely
going to be... It does come out. You'll see me, you'll recognize it, and I'm sure I'm going to plaster it on my social media.
Exactly, yeah, you will. Well, Sandra Kelly, thank you so much for taking the time to have this conversation with us. Certainly, I learned a lot about, you know, partly about the film industry, but mostly about your career, you know, your job, the kind of work that you do, being a Foley artist. And hopefully you can come back on the show, perhaps when the other show comes out, when your show with Paris Hilton comes out, Paris Hilton's production company, I should say, comes out. And best of luck with everything.
Thank you, and thank you for having me.
Yeah, well, we're always looking forward. We're always happy to see or to talk to people who have very interesting jobs, and yours is certainly, most definitely one of them.
Thank you, I appreciate it. Have a good day.
You too. Thank you very much.
Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. And that was our conversation with Sana Kelly, a Foley artist and the founder of Real Foley Sound. I don't know about you guys, but I certainly learned a lot about Foley just by having this conversation with her, and a lot more about the film industry as well, perhaps a little bit about how Foley artists can work together with directors, with producers, and with sound engineers as well. Certainly very interesting. That's the end of our interview with Sana Kelly, but don't go anywhere because See the Stories will continue after the break, so make sure you stay tuned on the 3-Hour News Show only on See Today.
Selamat malam pemirsa See Today, kita ketemu lagi di Ngonten, ngobrolin tentang Nusantara.
Dari gandrong gandring, Chris empuk gandring.
Iya, itu dia. Chris empuk gandring.
Jadi kota apa ini?
Dari mana? Kira menurut kamu ini daerah mana? Dari daerah mana? Dari negara lain ini?
Malaysia.
Dari China? India.
Asia Tenggara aja boleh gak? Namanya Sea Today Southeast Asian.
Ke Binjai mau migrasi.
Cakep.
Anjay, aku di pot sih.
Ya, aku cuma mau bilang hari ini kamu tuh cantik ya.
Aduh ya Allah.
Oke lah kalau penampilan dia gak sebaik itu, gak sebagus itu, gak seganteng itu. Tapi itu hatinya dia sebaik itu, dan tidak ada orang yang pernah gue temuin hatinya sebaik Mars.
Pemain!
Good morning Indonesia, Southeast Asia and the world. Rise and shine everyone. Back to our regular scheduled programming here on the Sea Morning Show. It is just past 6 a.m. and for the next 3 hours, myself along with my colleagues will be sharing with you all the latest news and updates from Indonesia and beyond. And time for your first sports update of the morning. We're going to begin with some updates from the world of football. We've got a talk show coming up as well and your latest viral news as well.
Welcome to See Today Business, your go-to source for the latest economic and business updates from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the globe.
Get ready for a power-packed show of insights, interviews, and analysis that will keep you ahead of the curve.
Join us Monday to Friday right at your lunch hour as we dive deep into the world of business, only on
See Today Business.
Hello, you're watching See Today Updates at 2 p.m. with me, Ara Satya. Let's begin the first story where the Indonesian government humanitarian aid for Palestine arrived at the Cairo International Airport on Thursday after a 12-hour flight with Garuda Indonesia. The humanitarian aid delivery was instructed by Indonesian President Joko Widodo, who explained that it showed the commitment of the Indonesian government to maintain world peace and be involved in humanitarian mission due to war or disaster.
Kayaknya lucu juga nih kalau dapur kita kasih warna, nggak cuma warna coklat, warna putih, yang ternyata emang berhasil naikin mood rumah ini sih.
Untuk jendela, pintu, dan furniturnya semuanya harus simple dan minimalis.
Kalau misalnya bolongannya dari utara, itu pasti lebih banyak angin yang masuk.
Still watching our signature segment, See the Stories on the 3-Hour News Show. So we did enjoy watching the interview with Foley artist Sana Kelly on creating sounds in movies or series. So now we know
that everything that we heard on the movie might not be the actual thing.
Right.
Like the bone cracking, the footstep sounds.
Yeah.
Or the gunshot bang. I did see some video on the making of the sound effect of the gunshot. Mm-hmm. It was actually with like a barrel, like a...
Right, so you can really hear the sound.
Yeah, the steel barrel that and they comes, just bang it, bam, bang.
Yeah, I didn't know they were still doing that. I thought everything was computerized.
Exactly, yes. I thought everything was digital already.
Yeah.
I mean, those mm-hmm. Gunshot bang from like movies.
Yeah.
I don't know. Fast and Furious.
Yes.
Bad Boys.
Yeah.
With Will Smith in it. Someone like, oh, everything is just... Everything you heard is not true. Oh, by the way, speaking of Will Smith, recently he made a post of a tourist destination in Indonesia. Yes. Have you seen it?
That's right, I have.
Wow.
You've seen it?
I thought he was actually in the country.
Oh, I know, I had myself fooled.
Yeah, right? Because he posted it.
Yeah.
That's Indonesia.
Yeah, so Smith also shared the tourist destination on his Instagram account, where he asked its exact location to his followers.
Will Smith recently went viral after posting a video of tourist attraction from Instagram user at Asep Mulyana Adam and asking its location to his followers. Many Indonesians then told the actor that it is located in West Java, Indonesia. Then it is known as Keranjang Sultan Situgunung in Sukabumi. The video shows several tourists sitting on rattan chair as it moves and travels along a 100-meter route across a river. It is claimed as one of the best rides for visitors who want to feel an adrenaline rush. Meanwhile, Indonesian Tourism and Creative Economy Minister Sandiaga Uno also responded to Smith's Instagram post and appreciated him for posting the local tourist attraction. Since it went viral, Keranjang Sultan Situgunung Sukabumi have gained popularity among tourists during the holidays.
I mean, what better way than to have Will Smith advertise it,
I know, right?
Free advertisement.
Free advertisement
by Will Smith.
Exactly. So it's okay if we didn't have Taylor Swift in the country. We could have Will Smith.
Exactly.
Right?
So when I actually checked it out, when it actually came out on my feed the other day, I don't think Will Smith had posted it yet. Mm. So the likes and comments were still minimal. But I thought, oh wow, I didn't know this place existed here and around.
True.
Yeah, yeah. Jakarta, not too far away from where we are. And so we've seen that the Keranjang Sultan in Sukabumi went viral because of Will Smith. And indeed, actually, every region here in Indonesia has its own charm.
I agree. And when we're talking about experience crossing river and beyond, I have some cool places in mind. It includes Yogyakarta. Oh. What about you?
Yes.
I mean, Yogyakarta is adjacent to your hometown, to your mom's hometown.
It is. So I think I know which one you're right about. That's also
and
one of my favorites.
The tubing experience.
Ooh.
I love that.
One of my favorites.
Well, you know what? I'm with Hans too, okay? Yogyakarta actually has it all, from beaches, hills, water park, and extreme tourist destination. And there's this place called Timang Beach where it offers extreme gondola rides. So let's take a look.
I know that Yani would not take this particular ride. So Timang Beach lies between Siung and Sundak Beach in Gunung Kidul. And one of the one of its attraction is the gondola ride.
Yes, now if you're looking for an adrenaline rush or if you're an adrenaline junkie, you have to give this a try. The ride costs around 200,000 rupiahs or around $12.
And it was featured in one episode of Korean variety show The Running Man with Lee Kwang-soo going on a ride and got scared.
The gondola ride started operation in 1997. It was established by local lobster farmers.
Wow, it's been around since 1997.
Yeah, right? Yeah. So, I know that Yanni would not take this.
I would.
Why? You would?
I would. Oh my goodness. I know who I didn't know.
Take.
Yeah, I didn't know she was an adrenaline junkie.
Yes.
Wow.
No. You know what? It's okay. I'm just a sucker for amazing views. If it was actually in the middle of the jungle, uh-huh. I would not do it. But since it's, you know, by the beach, I think I have to.
My mind would go anywhere. Like, what if I fall in? What if something happened? It's been there since 1997. I don't know.
But you know what? Based on some conversations with me and my friends, they're actually having kids and stuff. This kind of thing only happened
after kids.
Okay. After kids.
So. I'll let you know after I have kids and maybe I'll join you. All right, and now from Yogyakarta, let's move on to Cirebon in West Java to spend our Eid holiday in the Taman Sari Sunyaragi Cave.
One of the famous historical sites in Cirebon is Gua Sunyaragi or Taman Sari Sunyaragi. The cave served as a resting place for the Sultan of Cirebon and his family, and was also a place for meditation, strategy sessions against the Dutch during the colonial times, and practice for the palace soldiers.
This historical building has a unique structure decorated with coral rocks at each point, which gather like clouds called Wadasan. So these Wadasan protect the building complex from temperature changes, thus slowing down the temperature inside the building. So these Wadasan support the complex's function as a retreat while also providing a mystical and peaceful atmosphere for the palace family members to focus on meditating.
Now I feel like this is more Yanni's
alley. Yeah. Like, you know, just walking around.
Yes.
Is looking
very peaceful,
observing.
Yes,
right.
It's more for a chill day. Maybe after we go on that to calm ourselves down.
Look at that,
beautiful.
So every bathing place of the previous kings should be called Taman Sari in Indonesian, isn't it?
Right. Yes.
Because if I'm mistaken,
in Bali as well,
and also in Yogyakarta, they also have Taman Sari, right? So yeah, it's actually a cool place to go to.
Yeah, one of ones to add to your bucket list if you're visiting Indonesia. All right. With that being said, we are going for another break, but don't go anywhere just yet because when we return, see the stories will continue. Stay tuned.
Absolutely delicious.
You know, it's actually pretty good.
Satu, dua, tiga. Indonesia!
Come see the nature, only on See Indonesia.
Come see the beauty, only on See Indonesia.
Only on See Indonesia.
Ready to score a touchdown?
Oh, I'm born ready.
Let's go.
Let's go.
Go.
Figur publik kok kere.
Perlombaan ini tuh seperti mendaki Everest 3 kali.
Apa sih yang dicari? Bini setuju aja?
Harus setuju, saya jadi badut.
Siapa sih yang ngajarin kamu sekuat ini?
Ada Pak Habibie katanya gitu bikin.
Bikin pesawat.
Bikin pesawat gitu.
Simsalabim.
Simsalabim.
Abrakadabra.
Abrakadabra.
Singgobangkosir.
Singgobangkosir.
Pala botak nggak bisa disisir.
Pala botak nggak bisa.
Selamat malam pemirsa, si Today kita ketemu lagi di Ngonten ngobrolin tentang Nusantara.
Jadi gandrong gandring, Chris empuk gandring.
Iya itu dia.
Chris empuk gandring. Ah, ini. Apa ini?
Dari mana kira menurut kamu ini dari mana? Dari daerah mana? Dari negara lain ini?
Malaysia.
Dari China.
Bukan.
India.
Asia Tenggara aja boleh gak? Namanya si Today, si Today Southeast Asian.
May the spirit of it bring us peace, joy, and success in all aspects of our life. Feliz Idul Fitri, Id Mubarak.
Kayaknya kalau gue pakai warna itu hari ini akan senang deh.
Ya kan gue menikah, jadi saya masih dapat angpau sih.
Yang gue yang penting apa yang gue makan bisa gue buang pada saat gue olahraga. Gitu.
Welcome back, viewers. You're still with us three on See the Story segment. Now, since it's almost the end of the week, let's have some fun. Let's play game in See the Game.
All right, so we have here with us several bottles with different colors in the box, which we can't see. Ooh. And inside the box lies a ticket of prize.
So woohoo!
Not inside the box, but actually
on top.
This on top of the box. And the prize is our choice of food.
Mm-hmm. Yes, snacks.
So we have surabi. Mm-hmm. This is the Indonesian eggs rolled pancake. Sometimes people will actually have it, you know, open, have it rolled and stuff. But this is actually, it has a stuffing in it. And also we have chak kue, mm-hmm. or the fried dough, or Chinese called yutiao. And also martabak telur.
So yes, another form of pancake.
Yes, egg pancake. Right?
Wait, hold on. What's this one?
Oh, yes. So this is actually a bowl of soy milk. In which you dip the yutiao. Mm-hmm. So that's how the Chinese would actually eat it for breakfast.
All right, guys, I'm ready for my dinner. How about you? Let's get started. So who's going first? Let's play Hom Bim Ba.
Oh, yeah, that's the Indonesian thing. Okay.
Hom Bim Ba La Yum Gam Brek.
So you go first.
You guys do a rock, paper, scissors.
Rock, paper, scissors, go. You, Yanni, and me.
They know I'm hungry. Right. Okay. All right.
So we have to match all the colors with the ones in the box, right?
The box. Okay. So, I'm gonna go.
We don't know which color is which.
Yeah,
because also here we got all the monitors
closed.
So
we can't see anything.
Yes.
So I'm gonna start with my favorite color, red. Okay. Let's see.
Oh. No! Okay, well, I'm gonna go with green.
Oh my god.
No.
Right here.
Okay, we got this.
Green should be my favorite color. Let's see here. So I got surabi!
Yay!
All right.
Okay, you can collect that.
I'm gonna keep this.
All right. Next one. All right, I'm gonna go with the clear here. I'm gonna go for... Y'all, this is hard. Woo! All right, go Yanni.
Blue!
So,
All right. All right. What have you, man?
Orange. Let's go with...
Okay. Mm. All right. Okay. I really need to work for my dinner, so I'm gonna go back to red.
You actually didn't.
I really. Come on, guys. Y'all.
I think Karina will go home hungry.
I think so too.
Oh! Yay! What was that?
Martabak. Oh.
All right.
Okay,
we need to get it. Okay, I'm gonna leave the red.
Thank you.
Where did I put it? Oh, there. I put it there. So this might be it. Yes.
I really, guys, come on. Okay.
I got takwe.
My dinner, y'all. Okay.
I got a lot of
you know
things.
What? Here's my lucky red.
Yeah, okay. You're lucky red. You're lucky red.
Let's go.
Ah! Finally, I get my dinner and it's sarabi.
All right. Woo! So okay. You have the choice.
Yeah, last
it's
one.
It's actually yours.
Yeah. Ta-da!
Yay! Okay.
Wait.
So,
I didn't get your sarabia.
Oh my god.
Okay, we can trade.
Okay, you can trade. So which one is your wish list?
Sarabi,
which one is your wish list?
Martabak.
Oh, you don't get any sarabi.
Yes.
Okay.
Yay!
That's what we call friendship. That's what friends are
sharing
for.
Is caring, y'all.
Sharing is caring.
Can you share with me your dinner?
So we get to eat.
Can we eat it?
Yay! Okay.
So chocolate was actually my wish list. So
okay. This
is how you eat it. Ooh. Oh. Although this might be a little cold, but that's okay.
So you dip it in.
Dip it, because it's like chicken and waffle.
Okay.
Remember? Yeah. So it's savory and sweet.
Got it.
So
yes.
This also is something like that. So savory from the fried dough, mm-hmm. but sweet from the soy milk.
Mm. Still good?
Mm-hmm. Oh, good. Very, very good.
Very good. Okay. All right. Yanni.
All right, so this is sarabi. Like you said, there's always some fillings in here. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Usually I order chocolate, and I think this one is chocolate.
Yeah, so. That's chocolate.
Here we go. And now we dip it here. Oh, no.
No.
We don't.
All right, and I finally get my dinner. I'm so happy. Here we have my wish list, the martabak. So for martabak, we usually have sweet and savory.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I'm a savory person, so I picked the savory martabak, which is pancake, typically, fat pancake with eggs. And here we have beef filling as well. Mm-hmm. And we don't eat it dry. Well, you can't eat it dry, but here we have the dipping sauce, which is soy sauce with cucumber. So we dip it in. Ooh. Oh.
Oh, look at that dripping of sauce. Oh. All right.
Mm.
So this is actually the start of our dinner.
Mm-hmm.
So this is actually
it's so good.
All right, we're gonna keep eating here. All right, we'll be back with your daily dose of entertainment on the last segment of the show. You don't want to miss that, so don't go anywhere. Mm-hmm.
Binjai mau migrasi.
Cakep.
Anjay, aku deport sih.
Ya, aku cuma mau bilang hari ini kamu tuh cantik loh.
Aduh ya Allah. Kalau ini.
Okay lah kalau penampilan dia enggak sebaik itu, enggak sebagus itu, enggak seganteng itu, tapi tuh hatinya dia sebaik itu dan tidak ada orang yang pernah gue temuin hatinya sebaik Mars.
Pemain.
Ke
Good morning, Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and the world. Rise and shine, everyone. Back to our regular scheduled programming here on the C Morning Show. It is just past 6 in the a.m. And for the next 3 hours, myself along with my colleagues will be sharing with you all the latest news and updates from Indonesia and beyond. And time for your first sports update of the morning. We're going to begin with some updates from the world of football. We've got a talk show coming up as well and your latest viral news as well.
Welcome to City Day Business, your go-to source for the latest economic and business updates from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the globe.
Get ready for a power-packed show of insights, interviews, and analysis that will keep you ahead of the curve.
Join us Monday to Friday right at your lunch hour as we dive deep into the world of business, only on
City Day Business.
Hello, you're watching C Today Updates at 2 p.m. with me, Aris Satya. Let's begin the first story where the Indonesian government humanitarian aid for Palestine arrived at the Cairo International Airport on Thursday after a 12-hour flight with Garuda Indonesia. The humanitarian aid delivery was instructed by Indonesian President Joko Widodo, who explained that it showed the commitment of the Indonesian government to maintain world peace and be involved in humanitarian mission due to war or disaster.
Absolutely delicious.
You know, it's actually pretty good.
Satu, dua, tiga.
Indonesia! Come see the nature, only on See Indonesia.
Come see the beauty, only on See Indonesia.
Only on See Indonesia.
Hello, you're back on the 3-hour news show and we're still eating.
We are.
Yeah, but you know what? What's good with these snacks is actually some
rice.
Movies to watch.
Rice.
Not warm rice.
That is also good.
Some movies to watch.
Okay.
I mean, some people would actually bring some to sneak it into the theater.
Oh, that's
actually good. But also, you can actually watch at home. Talking about movies, number of it were released right after Eid, targeting more viewers who are still enjoying their holiday.
Yes, and among them are Badarawuhi di Desa Penari and Siksa Kubur that were released on the same day.
Yes, first up is Badarawuhi di Desa Penari that was released on April the 10th. The film introduces Badarawuhi, a captivating yet terrifying dancer who holds sway over Desa Penari, or Village of the Dancers. The story follows a group of university students staying at the village for their project.
Badarawuhi lures them into her world where they face endless terrifying events. The only hope for survival is to escape the village. Helped by Kimo Stambul, the movie stars Aulia Sara, Maudie Efrosina, Jordi Pranata, Dinda Kanyadewi, among others. The film boasts 344,000 audience on its first day.
All right, next one. Siksa Kubur, or Silent Terror Grave Torture, follows a woman named Sita and her parents. After her parents' death in a suicide bombing, Sita no longer believes in religion. Now, she has since been looking for the most sinful person to prove that the afterlife or myth does not exist.
Helmed by Joko Anwar, the film stars Faradina Mufti, Reza Rahadian, Fahri Albar, Happy Salma, Slamet Raharjo, and Christine Hakim. The movie was watched by 257,000 viewers on its first day. So, which one do you want to watch first?
But actually, ooh, if you look into it, this is like a battle royale. Because Bandara Uhi di Desa Penari is actually the spin-off of the first movie, KKN di Desa Penari.
Right.
So that movie deemed to be the most watched movie in Indonesia.
Yeah.
With almost, if I'm not mistaken, correct me if I'm wrong, 10 million viewers.
Yeah.
Wow.
10 million viewers. And Siksa Kubur by Joko Anwar is actually from the same director and also the same movie house that produced what did we watch?
Pengabdi Setan.
Pengabdi Setan.
Ooh.
So Pengabdi Setan also got into the top 10 most watched movie
of all time.
Of all time. Wow. Indonesian.
There you go. If you are a horror film fan, you don't look like it. I can't say that I am. I probably would not be able to sleep for a month, maybe a year. But if you're like me, not a horror fan, this one might be for you. Mm. A24 has dropped its second trailer for Civil War with a budget of $50 million. Civil War is A24's most expensive film to date.
Citizens of America, people of the Florida Alliance, and the Western forces of Texas and California. We'll be welcomed back to these United States as soon as their illegal secessionist government is deposed.
You don't know what side they're fighting for.
Someone's trying to kill us. We are trying to kill them.
Warner Bros. Has released the first full-length teaser
of this movie called Civil War, right?
Oh, yes. That's right.
Yes.
All right, so.
So is that Warner Bros.? It's A24, right? Through Shining Sea.
Okay, I have a question for you guys. Horror films or war films? I was trying to think of a genre for this.
This looks like a torturing war movie.
Yeah.
That's like, so I thought it was Civil War, like the Avengers Civil War.
Yes. No. Oh.
It's not the Avengers Civil War.
I mean, I would close my eyes for both movies, but I think I would be able to sleep still after.
Oh, for this.
Yeah.
So apparently we have a lot of scaredy cows in the studio, in an array of news anchor. Not only Karina, but also Hilyani Hidranto, Rahma Alia.
Yeah.
Oh my God, a lot of you guys. Crazy Alexa.
Yeah. I would watch horror.
Oh, you did, you did, you did.
She just wouldn't go on the gondola.
Yeah, no.
It's too different. Yeah.
Heights. All right, let's move on to the next one. Warner Bros. Has released the first full-length teaser trailer for Joker Foliadu. Did I say that right?
Yeah.
Foliadu.
So starring Joaquin Phoenix and Lady Gaga. Amazing. The film follows Joker and Harley Quinn's prison-breaking plan.
Hey, Fleck, you got a joke for us today?
The Clown Prince of Crime and Harley Quinn are to the screen in the first full-length trailer, Joker Foliadu. The dark and gritty footage begins at Arkham Asylum, where Joker, played by Joaquin Phoenix, is locked up at the end of the first film. Arthur Fleck has a deranged meet-cute with another patient, Harley Quinn, played by Lady Gaga. After the chance encounter, they plan to break out of their straitjackets and take on the world beyond their padded cells. This leads them to the streets of Gotham, where they dance and twirl manically around the city. The original Joker movie was a massive blockbuster with $1 billion at the global box office, becoming the first R-rated film to pass the mark. It earned 11 Oscar nominations, including Best Picture. The movie won 2 awards, Joaquin Phoenix for Best Actor and Hildur Gunnarsdottir for Original Score. Joker, Folie à Deux, is set to hit the big screen on October 4th this year.
I'm telling you, whoever came up with that idea of a scene,
oh, that's good,
deserve a race.
Yeah, that was scary.
That was so good.
Yeah,
it felt so perfect at the end.
Wow.
And it actually fits Joaquin Phoenix.
Yeah.
Face.
Like
amazing. Okay, I'm gonna watch it. So
yes,
in my watch.
On my list, I would watch that.
Yeah, you come with me. All right, that does it for today's episode of the 3-Hour News Show on C Today. And be sure to also follow us on our social media. We are on Instagram, X, and YouTube channel at C Today News.
Yes, and C Today can now be enjoyed for those of you in Australia and Foxtel's OTT platform, Flash app, or if you're in Macau on cable TV channel 84. If you're in the Philippines, you can also watch the Converge Vision channel 58, and those in Singapore, Singtel Singapore channel 15.
And for Telkomsel users, you can also watch C Today on the Maxstream app. Don't forget to tune in again tomorrow, same time, same channel, and be sure to catch our morning show every single day at 6 a.m. I'm Hiliani Hidranto.
I'm Karina Basrawan.
And before we let you go, we want to remind you that the showing hour of 3-Hour News Show have gone back to normal to 5 to 8 p.m. My name is Hans Lango, and we'd like to say,
see Indonesia, see the world, see today.
Bye-bye.
...384 bulan menanti, berarti berapa tahun, Teh?
32 tahun.
Karena semua narasi mengatakan 32 tahun, maka kita ganti jadi 384 bulan tahun menanti. Dan Mas itu hadir juga untuk Indonesia. Satu dari 20 nama yang dibawa Coach Indra Safri dan tim ke SEA Games Kamboja... ...hadir spesial di Potsi kali ini, Muhammad Ferrari! Ate.
Muhammad Ferrari.
Apa yang lo tahu tentang
Rubicon?
Wow, pajak.
Pajak itu. Ya. Kenapa ke Rubicon langsung ke pajak?
Mau nggak mau. Soalnya jadi keingetnya itu.
Keingetnya itu, oke. Okay.
Lagian Rubicon bisa main sama Ferrari mah cepatnya beda. Apa yang lo tahu tentang Muhammad Ferrari, Ate?
Wih, banyak sekali. Beliau adalah adik tingkat gue di SSB Jagakarsa.
Adik tingkat lu? Jadi ternyata lu dulu di SSB Jagakarsa?
Iya, beliau kan posisinya back. Kalau gue terpojok. Posisi terpojok saat itu. Saya
Tapi lu bener di SSB Jagakarsa?
Iya, SSB Jagakarsa.
SSB Jagakarsa lapangan mana sih?
Lapangan Impres, apa tempatnya kampung gitu sih.
Di deket Brigif?
Deketnya lebih ke apa Setu Babakan.
Oh, Setu Babakan. Baik, Setu Babakan itu sekarang menjadi salah satu tempat wisata. Karena di situ ada Setu.
Setu.
Kemudian tempat David Nurbianto dan lain-lain. Pokoknya kalau yang yang Betawi pasti tahu. Dan di situ adalah tempat cabut gua kalau dulu zaman SD SMP di Desa Putra. Di nama situ? Sekolahannya. Karena belakangnya itulah Setu Babakan. Dan dulu belum jadi tempat wisata. Setelah gua lulus, wuh, sekarang jadi ngetop. Karena akhirnya jadi tempat wisata.
Dulu ngapain cabut ke sana?
Biasa.
Apa tuh?
Gua belajar tapi gua lebih maksimal di Setu.
Oh langsung. Lebih enak ya, aura-auranya enak.
Lebih dapet ya. Kalau di kelas suka buntu. Karena gua masuk ke kelas itu kalau pertandingan, kalau pelajaran bola doang.
Pelajaran bola?
Iya.
Gua dari kecil lo suka bola.
Karena di Desa Putra itu kita punya dua lapangan bola. Aha. Satu lapangan gede, satu lapangan kecil. Di situ ada panti asuhan juga namanya Desa Putra. Nah gua selalu main tiap sore.
Oh.
Makanya gua akhirnya jadi komentator bola. Karena gua tidak diizinin jadi pemain bola profesional oleh orang tua gua.
Oke. Okay. Di lapangan itu?
Lapangan itu. Jadi kalau ada anak-anak sekarang jadi para pemain-pemain tim nasional dari daerah Jagakarsa.
Ya.
Seperti Ferrari, ada Indra Kaffi, ada Andri Tani. Dan juga teman-teman hasil. Gue kepikiran itu tempat main gue dari dulu.
Oh, udah anak lama.
Ya gila. Kata jebret.
Dari situ.
Karena dari Jagakarsa.
Lu lagi nonton-nonton jebret.
Main.
Oh, main.
Dulu gue main. Jadi kalau tendangan
kecil.
Playmaker bosku. Okay. Cuman yang pada level-levelnya Bima Sakti Kurniawan yang tahu permainan gue lah. Ya, kalau mereka pasti ketawain gue.
Iya, kayak
Ismet Sofyan umpan ke BP. Selain Ismet yang bisa ngumpan gitu ke BP cuma gue.
Cuma lu?
Lu tanya sama BP. Telepon
sekarang BP-nya Bambang Pamungkas tapi kan.
Iya masa lu kirain Bambang Sape? Bambang Purjianto? Beda dong. Tapi Ferrari ini mau gak mau kita tanya dulu nih. Karena perlu untuk dipotong jadi satu konten sendiri, ya kan? Nama lu kenapa Ferrari?
Iya, kenapa dari nama itu? Apakah dulu mungkin gue mikirnya adalah suka balap-balap mobil, jadi anaknya dikasih nama Ferrari.
Lebih ke apa ya? Karena apa lahirku cepet kan, dan orang tua bilang aku nanya, lah kok lahir cepet doang, kenapa bisa nama Ferrari? Dan satu hal lain mungkin karena apa orang tua juga dari olahraga, kebetulan dari voli dan pengen punya anak yang namanya Ferrari juga pengen lebih terkenal sih, lebih cepat dikenal orang. Karena kan nama Ferrari juga jarang di lingkungan sekitar rumah itu sih.
Jadi akhirnya cepetnya
gacor. Emang kalau normal 9 bulan. Emang lu lahir cepetnya?
Ya maksudnya dalam proses persalinan.
Proses persalinan ini langsung
cut. Kayak lagi kena ini, apa tuh, uang kaget.
Wow.
Cepet.
Langsung keluar ya?
Langsung keluar.
Dan itu berpengaruh gak dengan prestasi kamu yang katanya pernah jadi juara lari tingkat provinsi DKI?
Pengaruhnya sih dalam proses lari kayak maraton. Maraton alhamdulillah aku maksudnya dari kelas 3 SD di cabang-cabang kayak Jakarta gitu. Alhamdulillah sih maksudnya bisa bersaing sama kakak-kakak kelas yang di atas aku sih.
Ikut kelas 3 SD tuh ikut kelas berapa meter?
Maksudnya maraton 5
km. 5 km ya. Maraton.
Dari kelas 3 SD?
Iya, kelas 3 SD ingat banget.
Sampai kelas 4 itu maraton terus?
Enggak dong.
Dia biasanya kelas 4.
Dipotong-potong, Teh. Agak dia lari terus.
Oh, dipotong-potong.
Iya.
Sampai staff.
Tapi Ferrari-nya nulisnya yang benar R-nya 2 di
belakang.
Depan apa belakang?
Oh, di belakang. Ya, kalau yang mobil tuh
depan.
Di depan.
Di depan Ferrari.
Nah, jadi dari awal orang tuanya udah tahu tentang hak cipta dan merek.
Iya, benar.
Tidak sama.
Tidak sama.
Takutnya nanti suruh take down. Kayak video yang kena take down.
Iya, benar.
Tapi berarti emang suka olahraga dari kecil?
Ya, emang dari lingkungan sih maksudnya.
Sering, orang tua voli.
Iya, voli. Bapak ibu voli. Dan juga lingkungan kan pasti main bola anak kecil, anak gang gitu kan. Ya, hidup ya di lingkungan olahraga juga. Juga apa kampungan aku tuh suka olahraga, Pak RT-nya juga support olahraga.
Ini relate sama hidup gua.
Kenapa?
Karena dia kan warga Jalan Durian nih.
Iya, Jalan Durian.
Di daerah Jagakarsa.
Berarti pelan-pelan tuh jalannya tuh.
Karena durian. Ada tajam-tajam ya.
Ketusuk-tusuk.
Bukan dong. Nama jalannya aja.
Oh, jalan
bahkan di situ tidak ada pohon durian.
Oh, ada.
Ya, hanya jalannya aja, ya kan? Gua itu RT 11 RW 9.
Tanding
di Jagakarsa juga. Kelurahan Serengseng Sawah.
Jadi
emang dari dulu kita itu daerah sana 17-an voli itu bergengsi.
Voli paling bergengsi.
Bola bergengsi. Terus kemudian juga voli bergengsi, terus bola bergengsi.
Dua itu.
Iya biasanya dua itu emang. Ya
kan? Yang lain gak laku.
Yang lainnya dua itu emang.
Catur gak mau orang nonton
catur. Catur lebih ke Pak RT. Kalau gue inget tuh selalu dia dan kagak pernah kalah. Karena kalau kalah susah nanti dapat surat buat bikin KTP. Jadi emang di sana gila voli ya. Ya. Dan berarti lu beda generasi puluhan tahun sama gue nih. Tapi sama-sama bocah
masih,
serengseng.
Masih sampai sekarang itu ramenya.
Sampai sekarang. Dan itu akhirnya masuk jalur SSB itu kelas berapa? SSB
aku, Jaga Karsa. Aku SSB kelas 2 SD sih.
Ibu, 2 SD udah ya.
SD mana?
SD 06 Jaga Karsa pagi. Dekat rumah juga ya.
SD 06 Jaga Karsa pagi. Karena kalau siangnya dia berubah.
Jadi apa tuh?
SD swasta.
Iya ya?
Enggak dong. Ada kelas ada kelas sore kan?
Gue orang gak mau tertipu.
Enggak, ada kelas sorenya. Dan SMP di?
SMP di 254 Jaga Karsa juga.
254. Ini biar teman-teman dari SD 06 pagi Jaga Karsa, SMP 254 dan SMA 97.
Iya, 97.
Semuanya bisa nonton. SMA 97 tuh Brigif.
Brigif.
Brigif itu sekarang kalau keluar tol Andara.
Andara.
Gua belok kiri. Kan tiba-tiba macet.
Iya, iya.
Soalnya jalannya kecil.
Iya, iya, kecil banget.
Iya kan?
Satu nah, mobil doang tuh.
Tembusin ke arah Jaga Karsa itu namanya Jalan Brigif.
Jalan Brigif, gue pernah ngeliat kok Brigif.
Iya, jadi jalannya masih pas dua mobil doang.
Iya pas dua.
Ya kan. Sempit banget. SMA di situ ternyata banyak atlet-atlet ya.
Ya alhamdulillah sih ada sih. Futsal banyakkan sih futsal.
Oh futsal banyakkan. Futsal. Tapi kenapa akhirnya bola?
Tidak tahu juga.
Kenapa lo akhirnya memilih di bola?
Karena awalnya sih aku pengen masuk di Klat Ragunan. Okay. Dan emang nggak ada chance buat masuk situ. Ya nggak tembus. Jadi masuk Brigif aja karena di kisaran di Jaga Karsa emang yang favorit olahraganya emang Brigif kebetulan. Jadi aku masuk Brigif sih.
Masuk situ. Yeah. Itu masih terus di SSB Jaga Karsa?
Itu udah pindah di dari sebenarnya SMP udah pindah ke JFA di Halim.
Oh, yang bola ya?
Iya, bola.
Oh, JFA udah pindah juga.
Iya, JFA.
Berarti apa aja prestasi kalau di masa sampai SMA?
Ya, kalau paling apa Gotia Cup Cina.
Oh, yang ke China.
Iya, ya, terus ya. Juara EPA.
EPA.
U16 dan juara satu Piala Menpora.
EPA 16 tim apa?
Oh, Pestira Persikabo.
Oh, Pestira Persikabo.
Ya, terus Piala Menpora di Bali 2018 sama top skor Indonesia.
Uh-huh.
Dan setelah itu gabung ke Pestira juga.
Oh, banyak jadi dari awal emang main pemain belakang?
Awalnya sih dulu gelandang bertahan.
Nomor berapa? Maksudnya posisi
nomor 6.
Nomor 6 awalnya.
Iya, nomor 6.
Terus akhirnya mulai berubah ke
lebih suka defend jadi apa? Penempatannya ya di defender aja sih.
Oh, jadi emang lebih senang defend?
Iya, lebih senang defend.
Oh, dia lebih senang mempertahankan.
Mempertahankan ada orang lari, mana lo? Mana lo?
Kan itu namanya main galaksin. Ini lebih kayak kalau misalnya dia dihina teman-temannya, dia lebih suka mempertahankan. Gitu loh. Terus kemudian siapa dijelek-jelekin, dia mempertahankan.
Oh,
gitu. Iya, pokoknya dia tipe yang mempertahankan. Lu enggak lihat kalau gaya main dia?
Kayak mana tuh?
Siapa yang dilukain dia yang marah.
Jangan lukain teman gua.
Dia emang gitu kayak mainnya, suka mempertahankan.
Hebat, hebat.
Sesuai karakternya.
Keren.
Sampai akhirnya dia jegal orang di luar kotak penalti. Jadi kena
penalti.
Bisa gak dalam kotak. Itu di partai yang bawa kamu ya?
Lawan Kamboja.
Kamboja. Gue nonton tuh yang lawan Kamboja.
Nonton apaan?
Di luar kotak penalti. Kata gue jangan gitu.
Apa aja?
Gue biar kelihatan ngerti bola sih, Bung. Gue kemarin dibully loh karena gara-gara gak ngerti bola.
Itu Hamka Hamza loh.
Hah?
Itu Hamka Hamza loh.
Apa tuh?
Yang lu wawancarain dulu dibully sama penontonnya.
Iya.
Ini Ferrari.
Kenapa emang?
Jackmania.
Iya makanya gue tuh suka banget nonton itu.
Iya. Respect Jackmania.
Jackmania.
Tolong dibantu Ate ya.
I love you.
Juga Ultras Garuda. Tolong dibantu Ate karena dia lebih berusaha mencairkan aja.
Iya di sini posisinya co-host doang ya.
Iya. Kalau memang mau ngebully, udahlah ke Ferrari aja.
jangan juga.
Good morning, Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and the world. Rise and shine, everyone. Back to our regular scheduled programming here on the C Morning Show. It is just past 6 in the a.m. And for the next 3 hours, myself along with my colleagues will be sharing with you all the latest news and updates from Indonesia and beyond. And time for your first sports update of the morning. We're going to begin with some updates from the world of football. We've got a talk show coming up as well and your latest viral news as well.
Well,
Welcome to See Today Business, your go-to source for the latest economic and business updates from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the globe.
Get ready for a power-packed show of insights, interviews, and analysis that will keep you ahead of the curve.
Join us Monday to Friday right at your lunch hour as we dive deep into the world of business, only on
See Today Business.
Hello, you're watching See Today Updates at 2 p.m. with me, Aris Satya. Let's begin the first story where the Indonesian government humanitarian aid for Palestine arrived at the Cairo International Airport on Thursday after a 12-hour flight with a Garuda Indonesia. The humanitarian aid delivery was instructed by Indonesian President Joko Widodo, who explained that it showed the commitment of the Indonesian government to maintain world peace and be involved in humanitarian mission due to war or disaster.
Absolutely delicious.
You know, it's actually pretty good.
Satu, dua, tiga.
Indonesia!
Come see the nature, only on See Indonesia.
Come see the beauty, only on See Indonesia.
Only on See Indonesia.
Kayaknya lucu juga nih kalau dapur kita kasih warna, nggak cuma warna coklat, warna putih, yang ternyata emang berhasil naikin mood rumah ini sih.
Untuk jendela, pintu, dan furniturnya semuanya harus simple dan minimalis.
Kalau misalnya bolongannya dari utara, itu pasti lebih banyak angin yang masuk.
Ready to score a touchdown?
Oh, I was born.
Let's go.
Let's go.
Go.
สบายดีสุขสันต์วันอีดออฟฟิเรขอให้ผู้ชมรายการ See Today ทุกๆคนจงมีความสุขความสมหวังและสมปรารถนาทุกๆอย่างEat Mubarak to all.
Akhirnya masuk timnas?
Timnas ya waktu itu kan karena timnas yang sebelumnya yang buat persiapan Piala Dunia kan nggak jadi ya. Dan alhamdulillah ada chance buat.
Saya sebentar, sorry. Gak jadi yang bukan sekarang ya?
Bukan.
Yang sebelumnya. Karena nggak jadi juga karena COVID ya, itu termasuk tadi ya.
Terus apa seleksi pertama yang buat persiapan ke Turki itu juga sebelumnya aku ada cedera apa kaki retak.
Oh.
Jadi latihan pertama setelah cedera retak itu 3 bulan langsung di timnas.
Jadi langsung di timnas.
Iya, langsung di timnas.
Setelah retak.
Iya, setelah
retak. Apa justru karena retak lo dipanggil di timnas?
Enggak retak. Mungkin dong. Masa retak dipanggil aja yang sakit semuanya masuk, masa gitu.
Bukan, pelatih kan juga bisa lihat.
Wah. Apa?
Dia udah retak gini untuk bangsa ini udah dipanggil aja dah.
Oh, jadi ada ininya ya, ya perjuangan
ya. Ya, tapi itu hanya analisa. Ya, enggak ya, mungkin ya. Tapi ternyata udah retak akhirnya bisa masuk. Berarti ya,
masuk timnas.
Dari jenjang si top skor Indonesia juga ya. Kan di situ banyak ngambil
pemain-pemain.
Ada scouting untuk ya, ngambil pemain tim nasional Indonesia ya, kan.
Di usia muda.
Jenjangnya dari situ, baru kemudian main di Persikabo juga.
Ya, Persikabo.
Persikabo 1973.
Ya.
Eh bener gak sih dulu? Bener ya Persikabo 1973. Lu kan gak mungkin tahu bener apa enggak kan? Gue cuma membenarkan diri gue sendiri aja.
Persikabo 1973. Oh iya bener.
Bener ya?
Bener.
Oke bener. Di sana udah jadi back?
Di sana udah jadi back.
Udah jadi back. Kok akhirnya bisa ke Persija?
Waktu itu karena habis kontrak sih. Jadi ada tawaran dari Om Ganesha dari selaku direktur waktu itu.
Udah langsing dia sekarang ya?
Iya.
Diet ya?
Dan workout terus kayaknya.
Workout terus
ya? Ya ditawarin kontrak 2 tahun di Elite Pro 18 waktu itu sih.
Umur berapa waktu itu?
Ferrari. Waktu itu aku masih umur 17 sih.
Umur 17.
Umur 17 dan akhirnya dipanggil ke Persija.
Persija. Yeah.
Karena apalagi buat anak Jakarta begini, main di Persija, tidak lewat di Klat Ragunan, pasti cita-cita.
Iya benar.
Tapi itu berarti di umur muda udah banyak ibaratnya mencicipi ya, banyak lapangan gitu. Yeah. Perasaannya gimana tuh?
Taruh.
Mencicipi.
Jangan-jangan lu jawab itu.
Nah itu tuh bahasa ini.
Enggak, kalau itu mah gue fan football. Nyoba-nyobain lapangan.
Ya mencicipi.
Saweran. Lu mencicipi salah dong.
Itu bahasa
dia
bola.
Dia profesional pertanyaannya enggak
kan
gitu.
Sebelum timnas saya nanyanya.
Iya tapi enggak mencicipi lapangan dong.
Yaudah pernah merumput. Merumput. Ya, enak tuh.
Enak.
Gimana perasaannya di
gak,
usia
gua tuh,
muda?
Gua tuh belain lu supaya lu gak dibully. Oh,
iya, di usia muda banyak merumput. Nah merumput banyak lapangan kan gak enak tuh.
Gak maksud ya. Pernah dari masuk, usia muda iya. Lu udah bisa punya pengalaman mainnya di Persija, main di timnas, itu gimana?
Lebih bagus mencicipi tadi.
Iya kan? Jangan, nanti kalau mencicipi disangka acara kuliner.
Oh iya bener.
Iya. Gimana?
Perasaannya gimana?
Dari perasaannya ya seneng banget ya karena begitu cepet ya. Karena kan itu dulu targetnya masuk Persija kan aku masih umur 17.
Betul.
Dan target juga waktu itu masuk Persija 2020.
Ya.
Dan target emang sih ada sama papa juga. Target di tahun itu emang main di U20 ya Persija.
Oh.
Dan tapi gak nyangka karena apa doa mungkin ya doa lewat. Apa lewat jalur-jalur tahajud gitu emang. Benar kata bapak solawatin aja ya apa yang kamu mau. Alhamdulillah bulan Agustus baru masuk Persija udah dipanggil senior itu.
Itu. Namanya doa.
Doa itu penting.
Tidak terlihat tapi terasa hasilnya.
Tuh.
Lu juga kalau mau lebih cepat lagi dalam karir lu teh. Mungkin gimana? Lu gak tahajud. Mungkin lu gak doa.
Tahajud gua.
Nah, kok lama lu karir lu?
Ya karena orang beda-beda nasibnya. Mungkin tahajud gua agak telat jamnya. Agak telat.
Tapi bangga, sebangga apa memperkuat Persija dan doanya terjawab?
Ya sebangganya karena orang Jakarta juga kan.
Ya.
Juga cita-cita karena dari dulu kan cuman bisa lihat Persija latihan di Ragunan.
Ya.
Itu suatu kebanggaan juga. Dan waktunya begitu cepat juga apa dari usia 16 bisa gabung langsung senior itu bagi saya yang luar biasa sih.
Dan itu akhirnya bisa berbarengan dengan masuk timnas juga.
Iya langsung
timnas. Itu kayak merasa terlalu cepat gak sih Ferrari?
Merasa.
Apa karena Ferrari itu? Semua pokoknya jalur cepat.
Ya cepat banget sih ini karena dari apa di waktu itu juga apa di liga kan juga waktu mainnya juga belum yang apa kayak yang tahun ini kan maksudnya. Masih cuman berapa menit dan alhamdulillah bisa gabung U19 dan juga waktu itu dicoba di U23 di Korea sama Coach Sintayong. Dan alhamdulillah juga dari situ juga banyak belajar dari TC di Korea dan dapat kesempatan banyak banget belajar dari TC itu. Ya alhamdulillah pulang dari itu banyak pengalaman bisa bermain di Tolon Cup waktu itu.
Tolon Cup.
Alhamdulillah juga makin percaya diri juga sih.
Di mana Tolon?
Ya. Pakai nanya udah tau nggak tahu kan dia menimpali biar terus jawab
Prancis.
Gitu tahu
tulong bacanya tulong di Prancis benar nggak sih di Prancis
iya Prancis
benar Prancis lu udah punya paspor nggak
Schengen udah
visa Schengen ada lu
belum
berarti lu udah berapa kali dicap visa
banyak.
8 negara
banyak
umur berapa kamu sekarang
19
berapa capis negara banyak kan
banyak.
Lebih dari umurnya malah
sekarang umur lu berapa
30
berapa cap visa lu luar negeri
nggak ada
ya.
Gue malah dicap sebagai anak pembangkang
tapi waktu itu kan udah masuk di rencana timnas U20 yang rencananya main di Piala Dunia tapi waktu itu tidak jadi karena COVID
ya benar
waktu itu gimana ketika gagal tuh ya karena COVID
waktu itu aku belum masuk ke U20 yang COVID
sebelum,
itu.
Iya.
Ya sebelumnya waktu itu masih di EPA aja karena pengen berharap sih bisa main waktu itu karena ini sesuatu yang besar dalam main di Piala Dunia kan.
Betul.
Buat anak-anak muda ya ini chance buat bisa main di luar waktu itu sih.
Dan